Chapter 1. The Philadelphia into which Frank Algernon Cowperwood was born was a city of 250,000 and more. It was set with handsome parks, notable buildings, and crowded with historic memories. Many of the things that we and he knew later were not then in existence: the telegraph, telephone, express company, ocean steamer, city delivery of mails. There were no postage stamps or registered letters. The streetcar had not arrived. In its place were hosts of omnibuses, and for longer travel, the slowly developing railroad system still largely connected by canals. Cowperwood's father was a bank clerk at the time of Frank's birth, but 10 years later, when the boy was already beginning to turn a very sensible, vigorous eye on the world, Mr. Henry Worthington Cowperwood, because of the death of the bank's president and the consequent moving ahead of the other officers, fell heir to the place vacated by the promoted teller at the, to him, munificent salary of $3,500 a year. At once he decided, as he told his wife joyously, to remove his family from 21 Buttonwood Street to 124 New Market Street, a much better neighborhood, where there was a nice brick house of 3 stories in height, as opposed to their present 2-story domicile. There was the probability that some day they would come into something even better, but for the present this was sufficient. He was exceedingly grateful. Henry Worthington Cowperwood was a man who believed only what he saw, and was content to be what he was, a banker, or a prospective one. He was at this time a significant figure, tall, lean, inquisitorial, clerkly, with nice, smooth, closely cropped side whiskers coming to almost the lower lobes of his ears. His upper lip was smooth and curiously long, and he had a long, straight nose and a chin that tended to be pointed. His eyebrows were bushy, emphasizing vague, grayish-green eyes, and his hair was short and smooth and nicely parted. He wore a frock coat always. It was quite the thing in financial circles in those days, and a high hat. And he kept his hands and nails immaculately clean. His manner might have been called severe, though really it was more cultivated than austere. Being ambitious to get ahead socially and financially, he was very careful to whom or with whom he talked. He was as much afraid of expressing a rabid or unpopular political or social opinion as he was of being seen with an evil character, though he had really no opinion of great political significance to express. He was neither anti- nor pro-slavery, though the air was stormy with abolition sentiment and its opposition. He believed sincerely that vast fortunes were to be made out of railroads if one only had the capital and that curious thing, a magnetic personality, the ability to win the confidence of others. He was sure that Andrew Jackson was all wrong in his opposition to Nicholas Biddle and the United States Bank, one of the great issues of the day, and he was worried, as he might well be, by the perfect storm of wildcat money which was floating about and which was constantly coming to his bank, discounted, of course, and handed out again to anxious borrowers at a profit. His bank was the Third National of Philadelphia, located in that center of all Philadelphia and, indeed, at that time, of practically all national finance, Third Street, and its owners conducted a brokerage business as a sideline. There was a perfect plague of state banks, great and small, in those days, issuing notes practically without regulation upon insecure and unknown assets, and failing and suspending with astonishing rapidity. And a knowledge of all those was an important requirement of Mr. Cowperwood's position. As a result, he had become the soul of caution. Unfortunately for him, he lacked in a great measure the 2 things that are necessary for distinction in any field, magnetism and vision. He was not destined to be a great financier, though he was marked out to be a moderately successful one. Mrs. Cowperwood was of a religious temperament, a small woman with light brown hair and clear brown eyes, who had been very attractive in her day, but had become rather prim and matter-of-fact, and inclined to take very seriously the maternal care of her 3 sons and 1 daughter. The former, captained by Frank, the eldest, were a source of considerable annoyance to her, for they were forever making expeditions to different parts of the city, getting in with bad boys, probably, and seeing and hearing things they should neither see nor hear. Frank Cowperwood, even at 10, was a natural-born leader. At the day school he attended, and later at the Central High School, he was looked upon as one whose common sense could unquestionably be trusted in all cases. He was a sturdy youth, courageous and defiant. From the very start of his life, he wanted to know about economics and politics. He cared nothing for books. He was a clean, stocky, shapely boy with a bright, clean-cut, incisive face, large, clear gray eyes, a wide forehead, short, bristly, dark brown hair. He had an incisive, quick-motioned, self-sufficient manner, and was forever asking questions with a keen desire for an intelligent reply. He never had an ache or pain, ate his food with gusto, and ruled his brothers with a rod of iron. "Come on, Joe! Hurry, Ed!" These commands were issued in no rough, but always a sure way, and Joe and Ed came. They looked up to Frank from the first as a master, and what he had to say was listened to eagerly. He was forever pondering, one fact astonishing to him quite as much as another, for he could not figure out how this thing he had come into, this life, was organized. How did all these people get into the world? What were they doing here? Who started things, anyhow? His mother told him the story of Adam and Eve, but he didn't believe it. There was a fish market not so very far from his home, and there, on his way to see his father at the bank, or conducting his brothers on after-school expeditions, he liked to look at a certain tank in front of one store where were kept odd specimens of sea life brought in by the Delaware Bay fishermen. He saw once there was a seahorse, just a queer little sea animal that looked somewhat like a horse, and another time he saw an electric eel, which Benjamin Franklin's discovery had explained. One day he saw a squid and a lobster put in the tank, and in connection with them was witness to a tragedy which stayed with him all his life and cleared things up considerably intellectually. The lobster, it appeared from the talk of the idle bystanders, was offered no food, as the squid was considered his rightful prey. He lay at the bottom of the clear glass tank on the yellow sand, apparently seeing nothing. You could not tell in which way his beady black buttons of eyes were looking, but apparently they were never off the body of the squid. The latter, pale and waxy in texture, looking very much like pork fat or jade, moved about in torpedo fashion. But his movements were apparently never out of the eyes of his enemy, for by degrees small portions of his body began to disappear, snapped off by the relentless claws of his pursuer. The lobster would leap like a catapult to where the squid was apparently idly dreaming, and the squid, very alert, would dart away, shooting out at the same time a cloud of ink, behind which it would disappear. It was not always completely successful, however. Small portions of its body or its tail were frequently left in the claws of the monster below. Fascinated by the drama, young Cowperwood came daily to watch. One morning he stood in front of the tank, his nose almost pressed to the glass. Only a portion of the squid remained, and his ink bag was emptier than ever. In the corner of the tank sat the lobster, poised apparently for action. The boy stayed as long as he could, the bitter struggle fascinating him. Now, maybe, or in an hour or a day, the squid might die, slain by the lobster, and the lobster would eat him. He looked again at the greenish, copperish engine of destruction in the corner, and wondered when this would be. Tonight, maybe. He would come back tonight. He returned that night, and lo, the expected had happened. There was a little crowd around the tank. The lobster was in the corner. Before him was the squid, cut in two and partially devoured.
"He got him at last," observed one bystander. "I was standing right here an hour ago, and up he leaped and grabbed him. The squid was too tired, but he wasn't quick enough. He did back up, but the lobster, he calculated on his doing that. He's been figuring on his movements for a long time now. He got him today."
Frank only stared. Too bad he had missed this. The least touch of sorrow for the squid came to him as he stared at it slain. Then he gazed at the victor. "That's the way it has to be, I guess," he commented to himself. "That squid wasn't quick enough." He figured it out. The squid couldn't kill the lobster. He had no weapon. The lobster could kill the squid. He was heavily armed. There was nothing for the squid to feed on. The lobster had the squid as prey. What was the result to be? What else could it be? He didn't have a chance, he concluded finally, as he trotted on homeward. The incident made a great impression on him. It answered in a rough way that riddle which had been annoying him so much in the past. How is life organized? Things lived on each other. That was it. Lobsters lived on squids and other things. What lived on lobsters? Men, of course. Sure, that was it. And what lived on men? He asked himself. Was it other men? Wild animals lived on men, and there were Indians and cannibals, and some men were killed by storms and accidents. He wasn't so sure about men living on men, but men did kill each other. How about wars and street fights and mobs? He had seen a mob once. It attacked the public ledger building as he was coming home from school. His father had explained why. It was about the slaves. That was it. Sure, men lived on men. Look at the slaves. They were men. That's what all the excitement was about these days. Men killing other men. Negroes. He went on home quite pleased with himself at his solution.
Mother, he exclaimed as he entered the house, he finally got him.
Got who?
What got what? She inquired in amazement.
Go wash your hands.
Why, that lobster got that squid I was telling you and Pa about the other day.
Well, that's too bad. What makes you take any interest in such things?
Run, wash your hands.
Well, you don't often see anything like that. I never did.
He went out in the backyard, where there was a hydrant and a post with a little table on it, and on that a shining tin pan and a bucket of water. Here he washed his face and hands.
Say, Papa, he said to his father later, you know that squid?
Yes.
Well, he's dead. The lobster got him.
His father continued reading. Well, that's too bad, he said, indifferently. But for days and weeks Frank thought of this, and of the life he was tossed into, for he was already pondering on what he should be in this world, and how he should get along. From seeing his father count money, he was sure that he would like banking, and Third Street, where his father's office was, seemed to him the cleanest, most fascinating street in the world. Chapter 2 The growth of young Frank Algernon Cowperwood was through the years of what might be called a comfortable and happy family existence. Buttonwood Street, where he spent the first 10 years of his life, was a lovely place for a boy to live. It contained mostly small 2- and 3-story red-brick houses, with small white marble steps leading up to the front door, and thin white marble trimmings outlining the front door and windows. There were trees in the street, plenty of them. The road pavement was of big, round cobblestones, made bright and clean by the rains, and the sidewalks were of red brick, and always damp and cool. In the rear was a yard, with trees and grass and sometimes flowers, for the lots were almost always 100 feet deep, and the house fronts, crowding close to the pavement in front, left a comfortable space in the rear. The Cowperwoods, father and mother, were not so lean and narrow that they could not enter into the natural tendency to be happy and joyous with their children. And so this family, which increased at the rate of a child every 2 or 3 years after Frank's birth until there were 4 children, was quite an interesting affair when he was 10, and they were ready to move into the new Market Street home. Henry Worthington Cowperwood's connections were increased as his position grew more responsible, and gradually he was becoming quite a personage. He already knew a number of the more prosperous merchants who dealt with his bank, and because, as a clerk, his duties necessitated his calling at other banking houses, he had come to be familiar with and favorably known in the Bank of the United States, the Drexels, the Edwards, and others. The brokers knew him as representing a very sound organization, and while he was not considered brilliant mentally, he was known as a most reliable and trustworthy individual. In this progress of his father, young Cowperwood definitely shared. He was quite often allowed to come to the bank on Saturdays, when he would watch with great interest the deft exchange of bills at the brokerage end of the business. He wanted to know where all the types of money came from, why discounts were demanded and received, what the men did with all the money they received. His father, pleased at his interest, was glad to explain so that even at this early age, from 10 to 15, the boy gained a wide knowledge of the condition of the country financially, what a state bank was and what a national one, what brokers did, what stocks were, and why they fluctuated in value. He began to see clearly what was meant by money as a medium of exchange, and how all values were calculated according to one primary value, that of gold. He was a financier by instinct, and all the knowledge that pertained to that great art was as natural to him as the emotions and subtleties of life are to a poet. This medium of exchange, gold, interested him intensely. When his father explained to him how it was mined, he dreamed that he owned a gold mine and waked to wish that he did. He was likewise curious about stocks and bonds, and he learned that some stocks and bonds were not worth the paper they were written on, and that others were worth much more than their face value indicated. "There, my son," said his father to him one day, "you won't often see a bundle of those around this neighborhood." He referred to a series of shares in the British East India Company, deposited as collateral at 2/3 of their face value for a loan of $100,000. A Philadelphia magnate had hypothecated them for the use of the ready cash,
Young Cowperwood looked at them curiously.
"They don't look like much, do they?"
he commented.
"They are worth just 4 times their face value," said his father archly.
Frank re-examined them.
"The British East India Company," he read. £10. That's pretty near $50.
$48.35, commented his father dryly. "Well, if we had a bundle of those, we wouldn't need to work very hard. You'll notice there are scarcely any pin marks on them. They aren't sent around very much. I don't suppose these have ever been used as collateral before."
Young Cowperwood gave them back after a time, but not without a keen sense of the vast ramifications of finance. What was the East India Company? What did it do? His father told him.
At home, also, he listened to considerable talk of financial investment and adventure. He heard, for one thing, of a curious character by the name of Steamburger, a great beef speculator from Virginia, who was attracted to Philadelphia in those days by the hope of large and easy credits. Steamburger, so his father said, was close to Nicholas Biddle, Lardner, and others of the United States Bank, or at least friendly with them, and seemed to be able to obtain from that organization nearly all that he asked for. His operations in the purchase of cattle in Virginia, Ohio, and other states were vast, amounting, in fact, to an entire monopoly of the business of supplying beef to eastern cities. He was a big man, enormous, with a face, his father said, something like that of a pig. And he wore a high beaver hat and a long frock coat, which hung loosely about his big chest and stomach. He had managed to force the price of beef up to 30 cents a pound, causing all the retailers and consumers to rebel, and this was what made him so conspicuous. He used to come to the brokerage end of the elder Cowperwood's bank with as much as $100,000 or $200,000 in 12 months, post-notes of the United States Bank in denominations of $1,000, $5,000, and $10,000. These he would cash at from 10 to 12% under their face value, having previously given the United States Bank his own note at 4 months for the entire amount. He would take his pay from the Third National Brokerage counter in packages of Virginia, Ohio, and Western Pennsylvania banknotes at par, because he made his disbursements principally in those states. The Third National would, in the first place, realize a profit of from 4 to 5% on the original transaction. And as it took the Western banknotes at a discount, it also made a profit on those. There was another man his father talked about, one Francis J. Grund, a famous newspaper correspondent and lobbyist at Washington, who possessed the faculty of unearthing secrets of every kind, especially those relating to financial legislation. The secrets of the President and the Cabinet, as well as of the Senate and the House of Representatives, seemed to be open to him. Grund had been about, years before, purchasing through one or two brokers large amounts of the various kinds of Texas debt certificates and bonds. The Republic of Texas, in its struggle for independence from Mexico, had issued bonds and certificates in great variety, amounting in value to $10 or $15 million. Later, in connection with the scheme to make Texas a state of the Union, a bill was passed providing a contribution on the part of the United States of $5 million to be applied to the extinguishment of this old debt. Grund knew of this, and also of the fact that some of this debt, owing to the particular condition of issue, was to be paid in full, while other portions were to be scaled down, and there was to be a false or prearranged failure to pass the bill at one session in order to frighten off the outsiders, who might have heard and begun to buy the old certificates for profit. He acquainted the Third National Bank with this fact, and of course the information came to Cowperwood as teller. He told his wife about it, and so his son, in this roundabout way, heard it, and his clear big eyes glistened. He wondered why his father did not take advantage of the situation and buy some Texas certificates for himself. Grund, so his father said, and possibly 3 or 4 others, had made over $100,000 apiece. It wasn't exactly legitimate, he seemed to think, and yet it was, too. Why shouldn't such inside information be rewarded? Somehow Frank realized that his father was too honest, too cautious. But when he grew up, he told himself, he was going to be a broker, or a financier, or a banker, and do some of these things. Just at this time there came to the Cowperwoods an uncle who had not previously appeared in the life of the family. He was a brother of Mrs. Cowperwood's, Seneca Davis by name, solid, unctuous, 5 feet 10 in height, with a big round body, a round, smooth head, rather bald, a clear, ruddy complexion, blue eyes, and what little hair he had, of a sandy hue. He was exceedingly well-dressed, according to standards prevailing in those days, indulging in flowered waistcoats, long, light-colored frock coats, and the invariable, for a fairly prosperous man, high hat. Frank was fascinated by him at once. He had been a planter in Cuba, and still owned a big ranch there, and could tell him tales of Cuban life, rebellions, ambuscades, hand-to-hand fighting with machetes on his own plantation, and things of that sort. He brought with him a collection of Indian curios, to say nothing of an independent fortune, and several slaves. One, named Manuel, a tall, raw-boned black, was his constant attendant, a body-servant, as it were. He shipped raw sugar from his plantation in boatloads to the Southwark wharves in Philadelphia. Frank liked him because he took life in a hearty, jovial way, rather rough and offhand for this somewhat quiet and reserved household.
"Why, Nancy Arabella,"
he said to Mrs. Cowperwood on arriving one Sunday afternoon and throwing the household into joyous astonishment at his unexpected and unheralded appearance.
"You haven't grown an inch. I thought when you married old Brother High here that you were going to fatten up like your brother. But look at you. I swear to heaven you don't weigh 5 pounds."
And he jounced her up and down by the waist, much to the perturbation of the children, who had never before seen their mother so familiarly handled. Henry Cowperwood was exceedingly interested in and pleased at the arrival of this rather prosperous relative. For 12 years before, when he was married, Seneca Davis had not taken much notice of him.
"Look at these little putty-faced Philadelphians," he continued. "They ought to come down to my ranch in Cuba and get tanned up. That would take away this waxy look." And he pinched the cheek of Anna Adelaide, now 5 years old. "I tell you, Henry, you have a rather nice place here."
And he looked at the main room of the rather conventional three-story house with a critical eye. Measuring 20 by 24 and finished in imitation cherry, with a set of new Sheraton parlor furniture, it presented a quaintly harmonious aspect. Since Henry had become teller, the family had acquired a piano, a decided luxury in those days, brought from Europe, and it was intended that Anna Adelaide, when she was old enough, should learn to play. There were a few uncommon ornaments in the room, a glass chandelier for one thing, a glass bowl with goldfish in it, some rare and highly polished shells, and a marble cupid bearing a basket of flowers. It was summertime, the windows were open, and the trees outside, with their widely extended green branches, were pleasantly visible shading the brick sidewalk. Uncle Seneca strolled out into the backyard.
"Well, this is pleasant enough," he observed, noting a large elm and seeing that the yard was partially paved with brick and enclosed within brick walls, up the sides of which vines were climbing. "Where's your hammock? Don't you string a hammock here in summer? Down on my veranda at San Pedro I have 6 or 7.
"We hadn't thought of putting one up because of the neighbors, but it would be nice," agreed Mrs. Cowperwood. "Henry will have to get one."
"I have 2 or 3 in my trunks over at the hotel. My niggers make 'em down there. I'll send Manuel over with them in the morning."
He plucked at the vines, tweaked Edward's ear, told Joseph, the second boy, he would bring him an Indian tomahawk, and went back into the house.
"This is the lad that interests me,"
he said after a time, laying a hand on the shoulder of Frank.
"What did you name him in full, Henry?"
"Frank Algernon."
"Well, you might have named him after me. There's something to this boy. How would you like to come down to Cuba and be a planter, my boy?"
"Well, I'm not so sure that I'd like to," replied the eldest.
"Well, that's straight spoken. What have you against it?"
"Nothing, except that I don't know anything about it."
"What do you know?"
The boy smiled wisely.
"Not very much, I guess."
"Well, what are you interested in?"
"Money."
"Aha! What's bread in the bone, eh? Get something of that from your father, eh? Well, that's a good trait. And spoken like a man, too. We'll hear more about that later. Nancy, you're breeding a financier here, I think. He talks like one."
He looked at Frank carefully now. There was real force in that sturdy young body, no doubt of it. Those large, clear gray eyes were full of intelligence. They indicated much and revealed nothing.
"A smart boy," he said to Henry, his brother-in-law. "I like his get-up. You have a bright family."
Henry Cowperwood smiled dryly. This man, if he liked Frank, might do much for the boy. He might eventually leave him some of his fortune. He was wealthy and single. Uncle Seneca became a frequent visitor to the house. He and his negro bodyguard, Manuel, who spoke both English and Spanish, much to the astonishment of the children, and he took an increasing interest in Frank.
"When that boy gets old enough to find out what he wants to do, I think I'll help him do it,"
he observed to his sister one day, and she told him she was very grateful. He talked to Frank about his studies and found that he cared little for books or most of the study he was compelled to pursue. Grammar was an abomination, literature silly, Latin was of no use, history, well, it was fairly interesting. "I like bookkeeping and arithmetic," he observed. "I want to get out and get to work, though. That's what I want to do."
"You're pretty young, my son," observed his uncle. "You're only how old now? 14?
13.
Well, you can't leave school much before 16. You'll do better if you stay until 17 or 18. It can't do you any harm. You won't be a boy again."
"I don't want to be a boy. I want to get to work."
"Don't go too fast, son. You'll be a man soon enough. You want to be a banker, do you?"
"Yes, sir."
"Well, when the time comes, if everything is all right and you've behaved yourself and you still want to, I'll help you get a start in business. If I were you and were going to be a banker, I'd first spend a year or so in some good grain and commission house. There's good training to be had there. You'll learn a lot that you ought to know, and meantime, keep your health and learn all you can. Wherever I am, you let me know, and I'll ride and find out how you've been conducting yourself."
He gave the boy a $10 gold piece with which to start a bank account, and, not strange to say, he liked the whole Cowperwood household much better for this dynamic, self-sufficient, sterling youth who was an integral part of it. Chapter 3. It was in his 13th year that young Cowperwood entered into his first business venture. Walking along Front Street one day, a street of importing and wholesale establishments, he saw an auctioneer's flag hanging out before a wholesale grocery, and from the interior came the auctioneer's voice.
"What am I bid for this exceptional lot of Java coffee, 22 bags all told, which is now selling in the market for $7.32 a bag wholesale? What am I bid? What am I bid? The whole lot must go as one. What am I bid?"
$18, suggested a trader standing near the door, more to start the bidding than anything else. Frank paused.
22, called another. 30, a third. 35, a fourth. And so up to 75, less than half of what it was worth.
I'm bid 75, called the auctioneer loudly. Any other offers? Going once at 75. Am I offered 80? Going twice at 75, and...
He paused, one hand raised dramatically. Then he brought it down with a slap in the palm of the other.
Sold to Mr. Silas Gregory for 75. Make a note of that, Jerry,
he called to his red-haired, freckle-faced clerk beside him. Then he turned to another lot of grocery staples, this time starch, 11 barrels of it. Young Cowperwood was making a rapid calculation. If, as the auctioneer said, coffee was worth $7.32 a bag in the open market, and this buyer was getting this coffee for $75, he was making then and there $86.04, to say nothing of what his profit would be if he sold it at retail. As he recalled, his mother was paying 28 cents a pound. He drew nearer, his books tucked under his arm, and watched these operations closely. The starch, as he soon heard, was valued at $10 a barrel, and it only brought 6. Some kegs of vinegar were knocked down at 1/3 their value, and so on. He began to wish he could bid, but he had no money, just a little pocket change. The auctioneer noticed him standing almost directly under his nose, and was impressed with the solidity of the boy's expression.
"I'm going to offer you now a fine lot of Castel soap, 7 cases, no less, which, as you know, if you know anything about soap, is now selling at 14 cents a bar. This soap is worth anywhere, at this moment, $11.75 a case. What am I bid? What am I bid? What am I bid?"
He was talking fast in the usual style of auctioneers, with much unnecessary emphasis, but Cowperwood was not unduly impressed. He was already rapidly calculating for himself. 7 cases at $11.75 would be worth just $82.25, and if it went at half, if it went at half...
$12, commented one bidder.
$15,
bid another.
$20,
called a third.
$25,
a fourth.
Then it came to dollar raises, for Castel soap was not such a vital commodity.
$26,
$27,
$28,
$29.
There was a pause.
$30,
observed young Cowperwood decisively. The auctioneer, a short, lean-faced, spare man with bushy hair and an incisive eye, looked at him curiously and almost incredulously, but without pausing. He had, somehow, in spite of himself, been impressed by the boy's peculiar eye, and now he felt, without knowing why, that the offer was probably legitimate enough, and that the boy had the money. He might be the son of a grocer.
I'm bid 30 for this fine lot of Castile soap. It's a fine lot. It's worth 14 cents a bar. Will anyone bid 31? 31, said a voice.
32, replied Cowperwood. The same process was repeated.
I'm bid 32. Will anybody bid 33? It's fine soap, 7 cases of fine Castile soap. Will anybody bid 33?
Young Cowperwood's mind was working. He had no money with him, but his father was teller at the Third National Bank, and he could quote him as reference. He could sell all of his soap to the family grocer, surely, or if not, to other grocers. Other people were anxious to get this soap at this price. Why not he? The auctioneer paused.
32 once, am I bid 33? 32 twice, am I bid 33? 32 three times, 7 fine cases of soap, am I bid anything more? Once, twice, three times, am I bid anything more?
His hand was up again.
And sold to Mr.
He leaned over and looked curiously into the face of his young bidder.
Frank Cowperwood, son of the teller of the Third National Bank, replied the boy decisively.
Oh, yes, said the man, fixed by his glance.
Will you wait while I run up to the bank and get the money?
Yes, but don't be gone long. If you're not here in an hour, I'll sell it again.
Young Cowperwood made no reply. He hurried out and ran fast, first to his mother's grocer, whose store was within a block of his home. 30 feet from the door, he slowed up, put on a nonchalant air, and, strolling in, looked about for Castile soap. There it was, the same kind, displayed in a box, and looking just as his soap looked.
How much is this a bar, Mr. Dalrymple?
He inquired.
16 cents,
replied that worthy.
If I could sell you 7 boxes for $62 just like this, would you take them?
The same soap?
Well, yes, sir.
Mr. Dalrymple calculated a moment.
Yes, I think I would,
he replied cautiously.
Would you pay me today?
I'd give you my note for it. Where's the soap?
He was perplexed and somewhat astonished by this unexpected proposition on the part of his neighbor's son. He knew Mr. Cowperwood well, and Frank also.
Will you take it if I bring it to you today?
Well, yes, I will,
he replied.
Are you going into the soap business?
No, but I know where I can get some of that soap cheap.
He hurried out again and ran to his father's bank. It was after banking hours, but he knew how to get in, and he knew that his father would be glad to see him make $30. He only wanted to borrow the money for a day.
What's the trouble, Frank? Asked his father, looking up from his desk when he appeared, breathless and red-faced.
I want you to loan me $32. Will you?
Why, yes, I might. What do you want to do with it?
I want to buy some soap. 7 boxes of Castile soap. I know where I can get it and sell it. Mr. Dalrymple will take it.
He's already offered me 62 for it. I can get it for 32. Will you let me have the money? I've got to run back and pay the auctioneer.
His father smiled. This was the most business-like attitude he had seen his son manifest. He was so keen, so alert for a boy of 13.
Why, Frank, he said, going over to a drawer where some bills were, are you going to become a financier already?
You're sure you're not going to lose on this? You know what you're doing, do you?
You let me have the money, father, will you? He pleaded. I'll show you in just a little bit. Just let me have it. You can trust me.
He was like a young hound on the scent of game. His father could not resist his appeal.
Why, certainly, Frank, he replied. I'll trust you.
And he counted out 6 $5 certificates of the Third National's own issue and 2 ones.
There you are.
Frank ran out of the building with a briefly spoken thanks and returned to the auction room as fast as his legs would carry him. When he came in, sugar was being auctioned. He made his way to the auctioneer's clerk.
I want to pay for that soap, he suggested.
Now?
Yes. Will you give me a receipt?
Yep.
Do you deliver this?
Nope. No delivery. You have to take it away in 24 hours.
That difficulty did not trouble him.
All right,
he said, and pocketed his paper testimony of purchase. The auctioneer watched him as he went out. In half an hour he was back with a drayman, an idle levee wharf hanger-on who was waiting for a job. Frank had bargained with him to deliver the soap for 60 cents. In still another half hour he was before the door of the astonished Mr. Dalrymple, who had come out to look at the boxes before attempting to remove them.
His plan was to have them carried on to his own house if the operation for any reason failed to go through. Though it was his first great venture, he was cool as glass.
Yes,
said Mr. Dalrymple, scratching his gray head reflectively.
Yes, that's the same soap. I'll take it. I'll be as good as my word. Where'd you get it, Frank?
At Bixom's auction up here, he replied frankly and blandly.
Mr. Dalrymple had the drayman bring in the soap.
and after some formality, because the agent in this case was a boy, made out his note at 30 days and gave it to him. Frank thanked him and pocketed the note. He decided to go back to his father's bank and discount it, as he had seen others doing, thereby paying his father back and getting his own profit in ready money. It couldn't be done ordinarily on any day after business hours, but his father would make an exception in his case. He hurried back, whistling, and his father glanced up smiling when he came in. "Well, Frank, how'd you make out?" he asked. "Here's a note at 30 days," he said, producing the paper Dalrymple had given him. "Do you want to discount that for me? You can take your 32 out of that." His father examined it closely. $62, he observed.
"Mr. Dalrymple, that's good paper. Yes, I can. It will cost you 10%, he added jestingly.
"Why don't you just hold it, though? I'll let you have the $32 until the end of the month."
"Oh, no," said his son. "You discount it and take your money. I may want mine."
His father smiled at his business-like air. "All right," he said. "I'll fix it tomorrow. Tell me just how you did this," and his son told him. At 7 o'clock that evening, Frank's mother heard about it, and in due time Uncle Seneca.
"What'd I tell you, Cowperwood?" he asked. "He has stuff in him, that youngster. Look out for him."
Mrs. Cowperwood looked at her boy curiously at dinner. Was this the son she had nursed at her bosom not so very long before? Surely he was developing rapidly.
"Well, Frank, I hope you can do that often," she said.
"I hope so too, Ma," was his rather noncommittal reply.
Auction sales were not to be discovered every day, however, and his home grocer was only open to one such transaction in a reasonable period of time, but from the very first young Cowperwood knew how to make money. He took subscriptions for a boy's paper, handled the agency for the sale of a new kind of ice skate, and once organized a band of neighborhood youths into a union for the purpose of purchasing their summer straw hats at wholesale. It was not his idea that he could get rich by saving. From the first, he had the notion that liberal spending was better, and that somehow he would get along. It was in this year, or a little earlier, that he began to take an interest in girls. He had from the first a keen eye for the beautiful among them, and, being good-looking and magnetic himself, it was not difficult for him to attract the sympathetic interest of those in whom he was interested. A 12-year-old girl, Patience Barlow, who lived further up the street, was the first to attract his attention, or be attracted by him. Black hair and snapping black eyes were her portion, with pretty pigtails down her back, and dainty feet and ankles to match a dainty figure. She was a Quakeress, the daughter of Quaker parents, wearing a demure little bonnet. Her disposition, however, was vivacious, and she liked this self-reliant, self-sufficient, straight-spoken boy. One day, after an exchange of glances from time to time, he said, with a smile and a courage that was innate in him,
"You live up my way, don't you?" "Yes," she replied, a little flustered, this last manifested in a nervous swinging of her school bag. "I live at number 141.
"I know the house," he said. "I've seen you go in there. You go to the same school my sister does, don't you? Aren't you Patience Barlow?"
He had heard some of the boys speak her name.
"Yes. How do you know?"
"Oh, I've heard," he smiled. "I've seen you. Do you like licorice?"
He fished in his coat and pulled out some fresh sticks that were sold at the time.
"Thank you," she said sweetly, taking one.
"It isn't very good. I've been carrying it a long time. I had some taffy the other day."
"Oh, it's all right," she replied, chewing the end of hers.
"Don't you know my sister, Anna Cowperwood?" he recurred, by way of self-introduction. "She's in a lower grade than you are, but I thought maybe you might have seen her."
"I think I know who she is. I've seen her coming home from school."
"I live right over there," he confided, pointing to his own home as he drew near to it, as if she didn't know. "I'll see you around here now, I guess."
"Do you know Ruth Merriam?"
she asked, when he was about ready to turn off into the cobblestone road to reach his own door.
"No. Why?"
"Well, she's giving a party next Tuesday," she volunteered, seemingly pointlessly, but only seemingly.
"Where does she live?"
"There in 28.
"I'd like to go," he affirmed warmly, as he swung away from her.
"Maybe she'll ask you,"
she called back, growing more courageous as the distance between them widened.
"I'll ask her."
"Thanks,"
he smiled. And she began to run gaily onward. He looked after her with a smiling face. She was very pretty. He felt a keen desire to kiss her, and what might transpire at Ruth Merriam's party rose vividly before his eyes. This was just one of the early love affairs, or puppy loves, that held his mind from time to time in the mixture of after-events. Patience Barlow was kissed by him in secret ways many times before he found another girl.
She and others of the street ran out to play in the snow of a winter's night, or lingered after dusk before her own door, when the days grew dark early. It was so easy to catch and kiss her then, and to talk to her foolishly at parties. Then came Dora Fittler, when he was 16 years old, and she was 14, and Marjorie Stafford, when he was 17, and she was 15. Dora Fittler was a brunette, and Marjorie Stafford was as fair as the morning, with bright red cheeks, bluish-gray eyes, and flaxen hair, and as plump as a partridge. It was at 17 that he decided to leave school. He had not graduated. He had only finished the third year in high school. But he had had enough. Ever since his 13th year, his mind had been on finance, that is, in the form in which he saw it manifested in Third Street. There had been odd things which he had been able to do to earn a little money now and then. His uncle Seneca had allowed him to act as assistant weigher at the sugar docks in Southwark, where 300-pound bags were weighed into the government-bonded warehouses under the eyes of United States inspectors. In certain emergencies he was called to assist his father, and was paid for it. He even made an arrangement with Mr. Dalrymple to assist him on Saturdays. But when his father became cashier of his bank, receiving an income of $4,000 a year, shortly after Frank had reached his 15th year, it was self-evident that Frank could no longer continue in such lowly employment. Just at this time his uncle Seneca, again back in Philadelphia and stouter and more domineering than ever, said to him one day, "Now, Frank, if you're ready for it, I think I know where there's a good opening for you. There won't be any salary in it for the first year, but if you mind your P's and Q's, they'll probably give you something as a gift at the end of that time. Do you know of Henry Waterman and Company down in Second Street?"
"I've seen their place."
"Well, they tell me they might make a place for you as a bookkeeper. They're brokers, in a way, grain and commission men. You say you want to get in that line? When school's out, you go down and see Mr. Waterman. Tell him I sent you, and he'll make a place for you, I think. Let me know how you come out."
Uncle Seneca was married now, having, because of his wealth, attracted the attention of a poor but ambitious Philadelphia society matron, and because of this the general contentions of the Cowperwoods were considered vastly improved. Henry Cowperwood was planning to move with his family rather far out on North Front Street, which commanded at that time a beautiful view of the river and was witnessing the construction of some charming dwellings. His $4,000 a year in these pre-Civil War times was considerable. He was making what he considered judicious and conservative investments, and because of his cautious, conservative, clock-like conduct, it was thought he might reasonably expect some day to be vice-president, and possibly president, of his bank. This offer of Uncle Seneca to get him in with Waterman and Company seemed to Frank just the thing to start him off right. So he reported to that organization at 74 South 2nd Street one day in June, and was cordially received by Mr. Henry Waterman Sr. There was, he soon learned, a Henry Waterman Jr., a young man of 25, and a George Waterman, a brother, aged 50, who was the confidential inside man. Henry Waterman Sr., a man of 55 years of age, was the general head of the organization, inside and out, traveling about the nearby territory to see customers when that was necessary, coming into final counsel in cases where his brother could not adjust matters, suggesting and advising new ventures which his associates and hirelings carried out. He was, to look at, a phlegmatic type of man, short, stout, wrinkled about the eyes, rather protuberant as to stomach, red-necked, red-faced, the least bit pop-eyed, but shrewd, kindly, good-natured, and witty. He had, because of his naturally common-sense ideas and rather pleasing disposition, built up a sound and successful business here. He was getting along in years and would gladly have welcomed the hearty cooperation of his son if the latter had been entirely suited to the business. He was not, however, not as democratic, as quick-witted, or as pleased with the work in hand as was his father. The business actually offended him. And if the trade had been left to his care, it would have rapidly disappeared. His father foresaw this, was grieved, and was hoping some young man would eventually appear who would be interested in the business, handle it in the same spirit in which it had been handled, and who would not crowd his son out. Then came young Cowperwood, spoken of to him by Seneca Davis. He looked him over critically. Yes, this boy might do, he thought. There was something easy and sufficient about him. He did not appear to be in the least flustered or disturbed. He knew how to keep books, he said, though he knew nothing of the details of the grain and commission business. It was interesting to him. He would like to try it.
"I like that fellow," Henry Waterman confided to his brother the moment Frank had gone with instructions to report the following morning. "There's something to him. He's the cleanest, briskest, most alive thing that's walked in here in many a day."
Yes, said George, a much leaner and slightly taller man, with dark, blurry, reflective eyes and a thin, largely vanished growth of brownish-black hair, which contrasted strangely with the egg-shaped whiteness of his bald head. Yes, he's a nice young man. It's a wonder his father don't take him in his bank.
Well, he may not be able to, said his brother. He's only the cashier there.
That's right.
Well, we'll give him a trial. I bet anything he makes good. He's a likely-looking youth.
Henry got up and walked out into the main entrance looking into Second Street. The cool cobble pavements, shaded from the eastern sun by the wall of buildings on the east, of which his was a part, the noisy trucks and drays, the busy crowds hurrying to and fro, pleased him. He looked at the buildings over the way, all 3 and 4 stories, and largely of gray stone and crowded with life, and thanked his stars that he had originally located in so prosperous a neighborhood. If he had only bought more property at the time he bought this.
I wish that Cowperwood boy would turn out to be the kind of man I want, he observed to himself meditatively. He could save me a lot of running these days.
Curiously, after only 3 or 4 minutes of conversation with the boy, he sensed this marked quality of efficiency. Something told him he would do well. Chapter 4 The appearance of Frank Cowperwood at this time was, to say the least, prepossessing and satisfactory. Nature had destined him to be about 5 feet 10 inches tall. His head was large, shapely, notably commercial in aspect, thickly covered with crisp dark brown hair and fixed on a pair of square shoulders and a stocky body. Already his eyes had the look that subtle years of thought bring. They were inscrutable. You could tell nothing by his eyes. He walked with a light, confident, springy step. Life had given him no severe shocks nor rude awakenings. He had not been compelled to suffer illness or pain or deprivation of any kind. He saw people richer than himself, but he hoped to be rich. His family was respected, his father well-placed. He owed no man anything. Once he had let a small note of his become overdue at the bank, but his father raised such a row that he never forgot it.
"I would rather crawl on my hands and knees than let my paper go to protest," the old gentleman observed.
And this fixed in his mind what scarcely needed to be so sharply emphasized, the significance of credit. No paper of his ever went to protest or became overdue after that through any negligence of his. He turned out to be the most efficient clerk that the house of Waterman and Company had ever known. They put him on the books at first as assistant bookkeeper, vice Mr. Thomas Trixler dismissed, and in 2 weeks George said,
"Why don't we make Cowperwood head bookkeeper? He knows more in a minute than that fellow Samson will ever know." "All right, make the transfer, George, but don't fuss so. He won't be a bookkeeper long, though. I want to see if he can't handle some of these transfers for me after a bit."
The books of Messrs. Waterman and Company, though fairly complicated, were child's play to Frank. He went through them with an ease and rapidity which surprised his erstwhile superior, Mr. Samson.
"Why, that fellow," Samson told another clerk on the first day he had seen Cowperwood work, "he's too brisk. He's going to make a bad break. I know that kind. Wait a little bit until we get one of those rush credit and transfer days."
But the bad break Mr. Samson anticipated did not materialize. In less than a week, Cowperwood knew the financial condition of the Messrs. Waterman as well as they did. Better. To a dollar. He knew how their accounts were distributed, from what section they drew the most business, who sent poor produce and good. The varying prices for a year told that. To satisfy himself, he ran back over certain accounts in the ledger, verifying his suspicions. Bookkeeping did not interest him except as a record, a demonstration of a firm's life. He knew he would not do this long. Something else would happen. But he saw instantly what the grain and commission business was, every detail of it. He saw where, for want of greater activity in offering the goods consigned, quicker communication with shippers and buyers, a better working agreement with surrounding commission men, this house, or rather its customers, for it had nothing, endured severe losses. A man would ship a towboat or a carload of fruit or vegetables against a supposedly rising or stable market. But if 10 other men did the same thing at the same time, or other commission men were flooded with fruit or vegetables, and there was no way of disposing of them within a reasonable time, the price had to fall. Every day was bringing its special consignments. It instantly occurred to him that he would be of much more use to the house as an outside man disposing of heavy shipments, but he hesitated to say anything so soon. More than likely, things would adjust themselves shortly. The Watermans, Henry and George, were greatly pleased with the way he handled their accounts. There was a sense of security in his very presence. he soon began to call Brother George's attention to the condition of certain accounts, making suggestions as to their possible liquidation or discontinuance, which pleased that individual greatly. He saw a way of lightening his own labors through the intelligence of this youth, while at the same time developing a sense of pleasant companionship with him. Brother Henry was for trying him on the outside. It was not always possible to fill the orders with the stock on hand, and somebody had to go into the street or the exchange to buy, and usually he did this. One morning, when waybills indicated a probable glut of flour and a shortage of grain, Frank saw it first. The elder Waterman called him into his office and said,
"Frank, I wish you would see what you can do with this condition that confronts us on the street. By tomorrow we're going to be overcrowded with flour. We can't be paying storage charges, and our orders won't eat it up. We're short on grain. Maybe you can trade out the flour to some of those brokers and get me enough grain to fill these orders."
"I'd like to try," said his employee. He knew from his books where the various commission houses were. He knew what the local merchants' exchange and the various commission merchants who dealt in these things had to offer. This was the thing he liked to do, adjust a trade difficulty of this nature. It was pleasant to be out in the air again, to be going from door to door. He objected to desk work and pen work and poring over books. As he said in later years, his brain was his office. He hurried to the principal commission merchants, learning what the state of the flour market was, and offering his surplus at the very rate he would have expected to get for it if there had been no prospective glut. Did they want to buy for immediate delivery, 48 hours being immediate, 600 barrels of prime flour? He would offer it at $9 straight, in the barrel. They did not. He offered it in fractions, and some agreed to take one portion and some another. In about an hour he was all secure on this, save one lot of 200 barrels, which he decided to offer in one lump to a famous operator named Genderman, with whom his firm did no business. The latter, a big man with curly gray hair, a gnarled and yet pudgy face, and little eyes that peeked out shrewdly through fat eyelids, looked at Cowperwood curiously when he came in.
"What's your name, young man?" he asked, leaning back in his wooden chair.
"Cowperwood."
"So you work for Waterman and Company? You want to make a record, no doubt. That's why you came to me?"
Cowperwood merely smiled.
"Well, I'll take your flour. I need it. Bill it to me."
Cowperwood hurried out. He went direct to a firm of brokers in Walnut Street, with whom his firm dealt, and had them bid in the grain he needed at prevailing rates. Then he returned to the office.
"Well," said Henry Waterman when he reported, "you did that quick. Sold old Genderman 200 barrels direct, did you? That's doing pretty well. He isn't on our books, is he?"
"No, sir."
"I thought not. Well, if you can do that sort of work on the street, you won't be on the books long."
Thereafter, in the course of time, Frank became a familiar figure in the commission district and on change, the produce exchange, striking balances for his employer, picking up odd lots of things they needed, soliciting new customers, breaking gluts by disposing of odd lots in unexpected quarters. Indeed, the Watermans were astonished at his facility in this respect. He had an uncanny faculty for getting appreciative hearings, making friends, being introduced into new realms. New life began to flow through the old channels of the Waterman Company. Their customers were better satisfied. George was for sending him out into the rural districts to drum up trade, and this was eventually done. Near Christmas time, Henry said to George,
"We'll have to make Cowperwood a liberal present. He hasn't any salary. How would $500 do?"
"Well, that's pretty much seeing the way times are, but I guess he's worth it. He's certainly done everything we've expected, and more. He's cut out for this business."
"What does he say about it? Do you ever hear him say whether he's satisfied?"
"Oh, he likes it pretty much, I guess. You see him as much as I do."
"Well, we'll make it 500. That fellow wouldn't make a bad partner in this business some day. He has the real knack for it. You see that he gets the $500 with a word from both of us."
So the night before Christmas, as Cowperwood was looking over some waybills and certificates of consignment preparatory to leaving all in order for the intervening holiday, George Waterman came to his desk.
"Hard at it," he said, standing under the flaring gaslight and looking at his brisk employee with great satisfaction. It was early evening, and the snow was making a speckled pattern through the windows in front.
"Just a few points before I wind up," smiled Cowperwood.
"My brother and I have been especially pleased with the way you have handled the work here during the past 6 months. We wanted to make some acknowledgment, and we thought about $500 would be right. Beginning January 1st, we'll give you a regular salary of $30 a week."
"I'm certainly much obliged to you," said Frank. "I didn't expect that much. It's a good deal. I've learned considerable here that I'm glad to know."
"Oh, don't mention it. We know you've earned it. You can stay with us as long as you like. We're glad to have you with us."
Cowperwood smiled his hearty, genial smile. He was feeling very comfortable under this evidence of approval. He looked bright and cheery in his well-made clothes of English tweed. On the way home that evening, he speculated as to the nature of this business. He knew he wasn't going to stay there long, even in spite of this gift and promise of salary. They were grateful, of course. But why shouldn't they be? He was efficient. He knew that. Under him, things moved smoothly. It never occurred to him that he belonged in the realm of clerkdom. Those people were the kind of beings who ought to work for him, and who would. There was nothing savage in his attitude, no rage against fate, no dark fear of failure. These two men he worked for were already nothing more than characters in his eyes. Their business significated itself. He could see their weaknesses and their shortcomings as a much older man might have viewed a boy's. After dinner that evening, before leaving to call on his girl, Marjorie Stafford, he told his father of the gift of $500 and the promised salary. "That's splendid," said the older man. "You're doing better than I thought. And I suppose you'll stay there?" "No, I won't. I think I'll quit sometime next year."
"Why?"
"Well, it isn't exactly what I want to do. It's all right, but I'd rather try my hand at brokerage, I think. That appeals to me."
"Don't you think you're doing them an injustice not to tell them?"
"Not at all. They need me," all the while surveying himself in a mirror, straightening his tie and adjusting his coat.
"Have you told your mother?"
"No, I'm going to do it now." He went out into the dining room where his mother was, and slipping his arms around her little body, said, "What do you think, Mammy?"
"Well, what?"
she asked, looking affectionately into his eyes. "I got $500 tonight, and I get 30 a week next year. What do you want for Christmas?"
"You don't say. Isn't that nice? Isn't that fine? They must like you. You're getting to be quite a man, aren't you?"
"Well, what do you want for Christmas?"
"Nothing. I don't want anything. I have my children."
He smiled. "All right, then nothing it is." But she knew he would buy her something. He went out, pausing at the door to grab playfully at his sister's waist, and saying that he'd be back about midnight, hurried to Marjorie's house, because he had promised to take her to a show. "Anything you want for Christmas this year, Margie?" he asked, after kissing her in the dimly lighted hall. "I got $500 tonight." She was an innocent little thing, only 15, no guile, no shrewdness.
"Oh, you needn't get me anything."
"Needn't I?" he asked, squeezing her waist and kissing her mouth again. It was fine to be getting on this way in the world and having such a good time.
Chapter 5
The following October, having passed his 18th year by nearly 6 months, and feeling sure that he would never want anything to do with the grain and commission business as conducted by the Waterman Company, Cowperwood decided to sever his relations with them and enter the employ of Tighe and Company, bankers and brokers. Cowperwood's meeting with Tighe and Company had come about in the ordinary pursuance of his duties as outside man for Waterman and Company. From the first, Mr. Tighe took a keen interest in this subtle young emissary.
"How's business with your people?" he would ask genially,
or,
"Find that you're getting many IOUs these days."
Because of the unsettled condition of the country, the overinflation of securities, the slavery agitation, and so forth, there were prospects of hard times. And Tighe, he could not have told you why, was convinced that this young man was worth talking to in regard to all this. He was not really old enough to know, and yet he did know.
"Oh, things are going pretty well with us, thank you, Mr. Tighe,"
Cowperwood would answer.
"I tell you," he said to Cowperwood one morning, "this slavery agitation, if it doesn't stop, is going to cause trouble."
A Negro slave belonging to a visitor from Cuba had just been abducted and set free, because the laws of Pennsylvania made freedom the right of any Negro brought into the state, even though in transit only to another portion of the country, and there was great excitement because of it. Several persons had been arrested, and the newspapers were discussing it roundly.
"I don't think the South is going to stand for this thing. It's making trouble in our business, and it must be doing the same thing for others. We'll have secession here, sure as fate, one of these days."
He talked with a vaguest suggestion of a brogue.
"It's coming, I think," said Cowperwood quietly. "It can't be healed, in my judgment. The Negro isn't worth all this excitement, but they'll go on agitating for him. Emotional people always do this. They haven't anything else to do. It's hurting our southern trade."
"I thought so. That's what people tell me."
He turned to a new customer as young Cowperwood went out, but again the boy struck him as being inexpressibly sound and deep-thinking on financial matters. "If that young fellow wanted a place, I'd give it to him," he thought. Finally, one day he said to him,
"How would you like to try your hand at being a floor man for me in change? I need a young man here. One of my clerks is leaving."
"I'd like it," replied Cowperwood, smiling and looking intensely gratified.
I had thought of speaking to you myself sometime.
Well, if you're ready and can make the change, the place is open. Come any time you like.
I'll have to give a reasonable notice at the other place, Cowperwood said quietly. Would you mind waiting a week or two?
Not at all. It isn't as important as that. Come as soon as you can, straighten things out, and I don't want to inconvenience your employers.
It was only 2 weeks later that Frank took his departure from Waterman and Company, interested and yet in no way flustered by his new prospects. And great was the grief of Mr. George Waterman. As for Mr. Henry Waterman, he was actually irritated by this defection.
"Why, I thought,"
he exclaimed vigorously when informed by Cowperwood of his decision,
"that you liked the business. Is it a matter of salary?"
"No, not at all, Mr. Waterman. It's just that I want to get into the straight-out brokerage business."
"Well, that certainly is too bad. I'm sorry. I don't want to urge you against your own best interests. You know what you're doing. But George and I had about agreed to offer you an interest in this thing after a bit, and now you're picking up and leaving. Why, damn it, man, there's good money in this business."
"I know it," smiled Cowperwood, "but I don't like it. I have other plans in view. I'll never be a grain and commission man."
Mr. Henry Waterman could scarcely understand why obvious success in this field did not interest him. He feared the effect of his departure on the business. And once the change was made, Cowperwood was convinced that this new work was more suited to him in every way, as easy and more profitable, of course. In the first place, the firm of Tighe Company, unlike that of Waterman and Company, was located in a handsome green-gray stone building at 66 South 3rd Street, in what was then, and for a number of years afterward, the heart of the financial district. Great institutions of national and international import and repute were near at hand. Drexel and Company, Edward Clark and Company, the Third National Bank, the First National Bank, the Stock Exchange, and similar institutions. Almost a score of smaller banks and brokerage firms were also in the vicinity. Edward Tighe, the head and brains of this concern, was a Boston Irishman, the son of an immigrant who had flourished and done well in that conservative city. He had come to Philadelphia to interest himself in the speculative life there.
"Sure, it's a right good place for those of us who are awake," he told his friends, with a slight Irish accent, and he considered himself very much awake.
He was a medium-tall man, not very stout, slightly and prematurely gray, and with a manner which was as lively and good-natured as it was combative and self-reliant. His upper lip was ornamented by a short, gray mustache.
"May heaven preserve me,"
he said not long after he came there.
"These Pennsylvanians never pay for anything they can issue bonds for."
It was the period when Pennsylvania's credit, and for that matter Philadelphia's, was very bad in spite of its great wealth.
"If there's ever a war, there'll be battalions of Pennsylvanians marching around offering notes for their meals. If I could just live long enough, I could get rich buying up Pennsylvania notes and bonds. I think they'll pay some time. But my God, they're mortal slow. I'll be dead before the state government will ever catch up on the interest they owe me now."
It was true. The condition of the finances of the state and city was most reprehensible. Both state and city were rich enough, but there were so many schemes for looting the treasury in both instances that when any new work had to be undertaken, bonds were necessarily issued to raise the money. These bonds, or warrants as they were called, pledged interest at 6%. But when the interest fell due, instead of paying it, the city or state treasurer, as the case might be, stamped the same with the date of presentation. And the warrant then bore interest for not only its original face value, but the amount then due in interest. In other words, it was being slowly compounded. But this did not help the man who wanted to raise money, for as security they would not be hypothecated for more than 70% of their market value, and they were not selling at par, but at 90. A man might buy or accept them in foreclosure, but he had a long wait. Also, in the final payment of most of them, favoritism ruled. For it was only when the treasurer knew that certain warrants were in the hands of a friend that he would advertise that such and such warrants, those particular ones that he knew about, would be paid. What was more, the money system of the United States was only then beginning slowly to emerge from something approximating chaos to something more nearly approaching order. The United States Bank, of which Nicholas Biddle was the progenitor, had gone completely in 1841, and the United States Treasury, with its sub-treasury system, had come in 1846. But still there were many, many wildcat banks, sufficient in number to make the average exchange counter broker a walking encyclopedia of solvent and insolvent institutions. Still, things were slowly improving, for the telegraph had facilitated stock market quotations, not only between New York, Boston, and Philadelphia, but between a local broker's office in Philadelphia and his stock exchange. In other words, the short private wire had been introduced.
Communication was quicker and freer, and daily grew better. Railroads had been built to the south, east, north, and west. There was as yet no stock ticker and no telephone, and the clearinghouse had only recently been thought of in New York and had not yet been introduced in Philadelphia. Instead of a clearinghouse service, messengers ran daily between banks and brokerage firms, balancing accounts on passbooks, exchanging bills, and once a week transferring the gold coin, which was the only thing that could be accepted for balances due, since there was no stable national currency. On change, when the gong struck announcing the close of the day's business, a company of young men known as settlement clerks, after a system borrowed from London, gathered in the center of the room and compared or gathered the various trades of the day in a ring, thus eliminating all those sales and resales between certain firms which naturally canceled each other. They carried long account books and called out the transactions.
Delaware and Maryland sold to Beaumont and Company. Delaware and Maryland sold to Tighe and Company.
And so on. This simplified the bookkeeping of the various firms and made for quicker and more stirring commercial transactions. Seats on change sold for $2,000 each. The members of the exchange had just passed rules limiting the trading to the hours between 10 and 3. Before this, they had been any time between morning and midnight, and had fixed the rates at which brokers could do business in the face of cutthroat schemes which had previously held. Severe penalties were fixed for those who failed to obey. In other words, things were shaping up for a great change business, and Edward Tighe felt, with other brokers, that there was a great future ahead. Chapter 6. The Cowperwood family was by this time established in its new and larger and more tastefully furnished house on North Front Street facing the river. The house was 4 stories tall and stood 25 feet on the street front without a yard. Here the family began to entertain in a small way, and there came to see them, now and then, representatives of the various interests that Henry Cowperwood had encountered in his upward climb to the position of cashier. It was not a very distinguished company, but it included a number of people who were about as successful as himself, heads of small businesses who traded at his bank, dealers in dry goods, leather, groceries, wholesale, and grain. The children had come to have intimacies of their own. Now and then, because of church connections, Mrs. Cowperwood ventured to have an afternoon tea or reception, at which even Cowperwood attempted the gallant in so far as to stand about in a genially foolish way and greet those whom his wife had invited. And so long as he could maintain his gravity very solemnly and greet people without being required to say much, it was not too painful for him. Singing was indulged in at times, a little dancing on occasion, and there was considerably more company to dinner, informally, than there had been previously. And here it was, during the first year of the new life in this house, that Frank met a certain Mrs. Semple, who interested him greatly. Her husband had a pretentious shoe store on Chestnut Street, near Third, and was planning to open a second one farther out on the same street. The occasion of the meeting was an evening call on the part of the Semples, Mr. Semple being desirous of talking with Henry Cowperwood concerning a new transportation feature which was then entering the world, namely, streetcars. A tentative line incorporated by the North Pennsylvania Railway Company had been put into operation on 1.5 miles of tracks extending from Willow Street along Front to Germantown Road, and thence by various streets to what was then known as the Cohocsink Depot. And it was thought that in time this mode of locomotion might drive out the hundreds of omnibuses which now crowded and made impassable the downtown streets. Young Cowperwood had been greatly interested from the start. Railway transportation as a whole interested him anyway, but this particular phase was most fascinating. It was already creating widespread discussion, and he, with others, had gone to see it. A strange but interesting new type of car, 14 feet long, 7 feet wide, and nearly the same height, running on small iron car wheels, was giving great satisfaction as being quieter and easier riding than omnibuses. And Alfred Semple was privately considering investing in another proposed line which, if it could secure a franchise from the legislature, was to run on 5th and 6th Streets. Cowperwood, Sr., saw a great future for this thing, but he did not see as yet how the capital was to be raised for it. Frank believed that Tighe and Company should attempt to become the selling agents of the new stock of the 5th and 6th Street Company in the event it succeeded in getting a franchise. He understood that a company was already formed, that a large amount of stock was to be issued against the prospective franchise, and that these shares were to be sold at $5, as against an ultimate par value of 100. He wished he had sufficient money to take a large block of them. Meanwhile, Lillian Semple caught and held his interest. Just what it was about her that attracted him at this age, it would be hard to say, for she was really not suited to him emotionally, intellectually, or otherwise. He was not without experience with women or girls, and still held a tentative relationship with Marjorie Stafford. But Lillian Semple, in spite of the fact that she was married and that he could have no legitimate interest in her, seemed not wiser and saner, but more worthwhile. She was 24, as opposed to Frank's 19, but still young enough in her thoughts and looks to appear of his own age. She was slightly taller than he, though he was now his full height, 5 feet 10 1/2 inches. And despite her height, shapely, artistic in form and feature, and with a certain unconscious placidity of soul, which came more from lack of understanding than from force of character. Her hair was the color of a dried English walnut, rich and plentiful, and her complexion waxen, cream wax, with lips of faint pink and eyes that varied from gray to blue and from gray to brown, according to the light in which you saw them. Her hands were thin and shapely, her nose straight, her face artistically narrow. She was not brilliant, not active, but rather peaceful and statuesque without knowing it. Cowperwood was carried away by her appearance. Her beauty measured up to his present sense of the artistic. She was lovely, he thought, gracious, dignified. If he could have his choice of a wife, this was the kind of girl he would like to have. As yet, Cowperwood's judgment of women was temperamental rather than intellectual. Engrossed as he was by his desire for wealth, prestige, dominance, he was confused, if not chastened by considerations relating to position, presentability, and the like. Nonetheless, the homely woman meant nothing to him, and the passionate woman meant much. He heard family discussions of this and that sacrificial soul among women, as well as among men. Women who toiled and slaved for their husbands or children, or both, who gave way to relatives or friends in crisis or crucial moments, because it was right and kind to do so. But somehow these stories did not appeal to him. He preferred to think of people, even women, as honestly, frankly, self-interested. He could not have told you why. People seemed foolish, or at the best very unfortunate, not to know what to do in all circumstances, and how to protect themselves. There was great talk concerning morality, much praise of virtue and decency, and much lifting of hands in righteous horror at people who broke, or were even rumored to have broken, the 7th commandment. He did not take this talk seriously. Already he had broken it secretly many times. Other young men did, yet again he was a little sick of the women of the streets and of the bagno. There were too many coarse, evil features in connection with such contracts. For a little while the false tinsel glitter of the house of ill repute appealed to him, for there was a certain force to its luxury, rich, as a rule, with red plush furniture, showy red hangings, some coarse but showily framed pictures, and, above all, the strong-bodied or sensuously lymphatic women who dwelt there, to, as his mother phrased it, prey on men. The strength of their bodies, the lust of their souls, the fact that they could, with a show of affection or good nature, receive man after man, astonished and later disgusted him. After all, they were not smart. There was no vivacity of thought there. All that they could do, in the main, he fancied, was this one thing. He pictured to himself the dreariness of the mornings after, the stale dregs of things when only sleep and thought of gain could aid in the least. And more than once, even at his age, he shook his head. He wanted contact which was more intimate, subtle, individual, personal. So came Lillian Semple, who was nothing more to him than the shadow of an ideal. Yet she cleared up certain of his ideas in regard to women. She was not physically as vigorous or brutal as those other women whom he had encountered in the Lupinars, thus far. Raw, unashamed contraveners of accepted theories and notions, and for that very reason he liked her. And his thoughts continued to dwell on her, notwithstanding the hectic days which now passed like flashes of light in his new business venture. For this stock exchange world in which he now found himself, primitive as it would seem today, was most fascinating to Cowperwood. The room that he went to in Third Street, at Dock, where the brokers or their agents and clerks gathered 150 strong, was nothing to speak of artistically, a square chamber 60 by 60, reaching from the second floor to the roof of a four-story building. But it was striking to him. The windows were high and narrow. A large-faced clock faced the west entrance of the room where you came in from the stairs. A collection of telegraph instruments, with their accompanying desks and chairs, occupied the northeast corner. On the floor, in the early days of the exchange, were rows of chairs where the brokers sat while various lots of stocks were offered to them. Later in the history of the exchange, the chairs were removed and at different points, posts or floor signs indicating where certain stocks were traded in were introduced. Around these, the men who were interested gathered to do their trading. From a hall on the third floor, a door gave entrance to a visitor's gallery, small and poorly furnished. And on the west wall, a large blackboard carried current quotations in stocks, as telegraphed from New York and Boston. A wicket-like fence in the center of the room surrounded the desk and chair of the official recorder, and a very small gallery opening from the third floor on the west gave place for the secretary of the board, when he had any special announcement to make. There was a room off the southwest corner, where reports and annual compendiums of various kinds were kept and were available for the use of members. Young Cowperwood would not have been admitted at all, as either a broker or broker's agent or assistant, except that Tighe, feeling that he needed him and believing that he would be very useful, bought him a seat on change, charging the $2,000 it cost as a debt, and then ostensibly taking him into partnership. It was against the rules of the exchange to sham a partnership in this way, in order to put a man on the floor, but brokers did it. These men, who were known to be minor partners and floor assistants, were derisively called eighth chasers and $2 brokers, because they were always seeking small orders, and were willing to buy or sell for anybody on their commission, accounting, of course, to their firms for their work. Cowperwood, regardless of his intrinsic merits, was originally counted one of their number, and he was put under the direction of Mr. Arthur Rivers, the regular floor man of Tighe and Company. Rivers was an exceedingly forceful man of 35, well-dressed, well-formed, with a hard, smooth, evenly chiseled face, which was ornamented by a short black mustache and fine black clearly penciled eyebrows. His hair came to an odd point at the middle of his forehead, where he divided it, and his chin was faintly and attractively cleft. He had a soft voice, a quiet, conservative manner, and both in and out of this brokerage and trading world was controlled by good form. Cowperwood wondered at first why Rivers should work for Tighe. He appeared almost as able, but afterward learned that he was in the company. Tighe was the organizer and general handshaker, Rivers the floor and outside man. It was useless, as Frank soon found, to try to figure out exactly why stocks rose and fell. Some general reasons there were, of course, as he was told by Tighe, but they could not always be depended on. "Sure, anything can make or break a market," Tighe explained in his delicate brogue. "From the failure of a bank to the rumor that your second cousin's grandmother has a cold. It's a most unusual world, Cowperwood. No man can explain it. I've seen breaks in stocks that you could never explain at all. No one could. It wouldn't be possible to find out why they broke. I've seen rises the same way. My God, the rumors of the stock exchange, they beat the devil. If they're going down in ordinary times, someone is unloading, or they're rigging the market. If they're going up, God knows times must be good, or somebody must be buying, that's sure. Beyond that, well, ask Rivers to show you the ropes. Don't you ever lose for me, though. That's the cardinal sin in this office." He grinned maliciously, even if kindly, at that. Cowperwood understood. None better. This subtle world appealed to him. It answered to his temperament. There were rumors, rumors, rumors of great railway and streetcar undertakings, land developments, government revision of the tariff, war between France and Turkey, famine in Russia or Ireland, and so on. The first Atlantic cable had not been laid as yet, and news of any kind from abroad was slow and meager. Still, there were great financial figures in the field, men who, like Cyrus Field or William H. Vanderbilt or F. X. Drexel, were doing marvelous things, and their activities and the rumors concerning them counted for much. Frank soon picked up all of the technicalities of the situation. A bull, he learned, was one who bought in anticipation of a higher price to come, and if he was loaded up with a line of stocks, he was said to be long. He sold to realize his profit, or if his margins were exhausted, he was wiped out. A bear was one who sold stocks, which most frequently he did not have, in anticipation of a lower price, at which he could buy and satisfy his previous sales. He was short when he had sold what he did not own, and he covered when he bought to satisfy his sales, and to realize his profits or to protect himself against further loss in case prices advanced instead of declining. He was in a corner when he found that he could not buy in order to make good the stock he had borrowed for delivery, and the return of which had been demanded. He was then obliged to settle practically at a price fixed by those to whom he and other shorts had sold. He smiled at first at the air of great secrecy and wisdom on the part of the younger men. They were so heartily and foolishly suspicious. The older men, as a rule, were inscrutable. They pretended indifference, uncertainty. They were like certain fish after a certain kind of bait, however. Snap, and the opportunity was gone. Somebody else had picked up what you wanted. All had their little notebooks. All had their peculiar squint of eye, or position, or motion, which meant, done, I take you. Sometimes they seemed scarcely to confirm their sales or purchases. They knew each other so well, but they did. If the market was for any reason active, the brokers and their agents were apt to be more numerous than if it were dull and the trading indifferent. A gong sounded the call to trading at 10 o'clock, and if there was a noticeable rise or decline in a stock or a group of stocks, you were apt to witness quite a spirited scene. 50 to 100 men would shout, gesticulate, shove here and there, in an apparently aimless manner, endeavoring to take advantage of the stock offered or called for.
5/8 for 500 P&W,
someone would call, Rivers or Cowperwood, or any other broker.
500 at 3/4,
would come the reply from someone else, who either had an order to sell the stock at that price, or who was willing to sell it short, hoping to pick up enough of the stock at a lower figure later to fill his order and make a little something besides. If the supply of stock at that figure was large, Rivers would probably continue to bid 5/8. If, on the other hand, he noticed an increasing demand, he would probably pay 3/4 for it. If the professional traders believed Rivers had a large buying order, they would probably try to buy the stock before he could at 3/4, believing they could sell it out to him at a slightly higher price. The professional traders were, of course, keen students of psychology, and their success depended on their ability to guess whether or not a broker representing a big manipulator, like Tighe, had an order large enough to affect the market sufficiently to give them an opportunity to get in and out, as they termed it, at a profit before he had completed the execution of his order. They were like hawks watching for an opportunity to snatch their prey from under the very claws of their opponents. 4, 5, 10, 15, 20, 30, 40, 50, and sometimes the whole company would attempt to take advantage of the given rise of a given stock by either selling or offering to buy, in which case the activity and the noise would become deafening. Given groups might be trading in different things, but the large majority of them would abandon what they were doing in order to take advantage of a specialty. The eagerness of certain young brokers or clerks to discover all that was going on and to take advantage of any given rise or fall made for quick physical action, darting to and fro, the excited elevation of explanatory fingers. Distorted faces were shoved over shoulders or under arms. The most ridiculous grimaces were purposely or unconsciously indulged in. At times there were situations in which some individual was fairly smothered with arms, faces, shoulders, crowded towards him when he manifested any intention of either buying or selling at a profitable rate. At first it seemed quite a wonderful thing to young Cowperwood, the very physical face of it, for he liked human presence and activity. But a little later the sense of the thing as a picture or a dramatic situation of which he was a part faded, and he came down to a clearer sense of the intricacies of the problem before him. Buying and selling stocks, as he soon learned, was an art, a subtlety, almost a psychic emotion. Suspicion, intuition, feeling, these were the things to be long on. Yet in time he also asked himself, who was it who made the real money? The stockbrokers? Not at all. Some of them were making money, but they were, as he quickly saw, like a lot of gulls or stormy petrels, hanging on the lee of the wind, hungry and anxious to snap up any unwary fish. Back of them were other men, men with shrewd ideas, subtle resources, men of immense means whose enterprise and holdings these stocks represented, the men who schemed out and built the railroads, opened the mines, organized trading enterprises, and built up immense manufactories. They might use brokers or other agents to buy and sell on change, but this buying and selling must be, and always was, incidental to the actual fact, the mine, the railroad, the wheat crop, the flour mill, and so on. Anything less than straight-out sales to realize quickly on assets, or buying to hold as an investment, was gambling pure and simple, and these men were gamblers. He was nothing more than a gambler's agent. It was not troubling him any just at this moment, but it was not at all a mystery now, what he was. As in the case of Waterman and Company, he sized up these men shrewdly, judging some to be weak, some foolish, some clever, some slow, but in the main all small-minded or deficient because they were agents, tools, or gamblers. A man, a real man, must never be an agent, a tool, or a gambler. Acting for himself or for others, he must employ such. A real man, a financier, was never a tool. He used tools, he created, he led. Clearly, very clearly, at 19, 20, and 21 years of age, he saw all this,
but he was not quite ready yet to do anything about it. He was certain, however, that his day would come. Chapter 7 In the meantime, his interest in Mrs. Semple had been secretly and strangely growing. When he received an invitation to call at the Semple house, he accepted with a great deal of pleasure. Their house was located not so very far from his own, on North Front Street, in the neighborhood of what is now known as number 956. It had, in summer, quite a wealth of green leaves and vines. The little side porch which ornamented its south wall commanded a charming view of the river, and all the windows and doors were topped with lunettes of small paned glass. The interior of the house was not as pleasing as he would have had it. Artistic impressiveness, as to the furniture at least, was wanting, although it was new and good. The pictures were, well, simply pictures. There were no books to speak of. The Bible, a few current novels, some of the more significant histories, and a collection of antiquated odds and ends in the shape of books inherited from relatives. The china was good, of a delicate pattern. The carpets and wallpaper were too high in key. So it went. Still, the personality of Lillian Semple was worth something, for she was really pleasing to look upon, making a picture wherever she stood or sat. There were no children, a dispensation of sex conditions which had nothing to do with her, for she longed to have them. She was without any notable experience in social life, except such as had come to the Wigan family, of which she was a member, relatives and a few neighborhood friends visiting. Lillian Wigan, that was her maiden name, had two brothers and one sister, all living in Philadelphia, and all married at this time. They thought she had done very well in her marriage. It could not be said that she had wildly loved Mr. Semple at any time. Although she had cheerfully married him, he was not the kind of man who could arouse a notable passion in any woman. He was practical, methodic, orderly. His shoe store was a good one, well stocked with styles reflecting the current tastes and a model of cleanliness and what one might term pleasing brightness. He loved to talk, when he talked at all, of shoe manufacturing, the development of lasts and styles. The ready-made shoe, machine-made to a certain extent, was just coming into its own slowly, and outside of these, supplies of which he kept, he employed bench-making shoemakers, satisfying his customers with personal measurements and making the shoes to order. Mrs. Semple read a little, not much. She had a habit of sitting and apparently brooding reflectively at times, but it was not based on any deep thought. She had that curious beauty of body, though, that made her somewhat like a figure on an antique vase or out of a Greek chorus. It was in this light, unquestionably, that Cowperwood saw her, for, from the beginning, he could not keep his eyes off her. In a way, she was aware of this, but she did not attach any significance to it. Thoroughly conventional, satisfied now that her life was bound permanently with that of her husband, she had settled down to a staid and quiet existence. At first, when Frank called, she did not have much to say. She was gracious, but the burden of conversation fell on her husband. Cowperwood watched the varying expression of her face from time to time, and if she had been at all psychic, she must have felt something. Fortunately, she was not. Semple talked to him pleasantly, because in the first place Frank was becoming financially significant, was suave and ingratiating, and in the next place he was anxious to get richer, and somehow Frank represented progress to him in that line. One spring evening they sat on the porch and talked, nothing very important, slavery, streetcars, the panic. It was on then, that of 1857, the development of the West. Mr. Semple wanted to know all about the stock exchange. In return, Frank asked about the shoe business, though he really did not care. All the while, inoffensively, he watched Mrs. Semple. Her manner, he thought, was soothing, attractive, delightful. She served tea and cake for them. They went inside after a time to avoid the mosquitoes. She played the piano. At 10 o'clock, he left. Thereafter, for a year or so, Cowperwood bought his shoes of Mr. Semple. Occasionally, also, he stopped in the Chestnut Street store to exchange the time of the day. Semple asked his opinion as to the advisability of buying some shares in the 5th and 6th Street line, which, having secured a franchise, was creating great excitement. Cowperwood gave him his best judgment. It was sure to be profitable. He himself had purchased 100 shares at $5 a share and urged Semple to do so. But he was not interested in him personally. He liked Mrs. Semple, though he did not see her very often. About a year later, Mr. Semple died. It was an untimely death, one of those fortuitous and in a way insignificant episodes which are, nevertheless, dramatic in a dull way to those most concerned.
He was seized with a cold in the chest late in the fall, one of those seizures ordinarily attributed to wet feet or to going out on a damp day without an overcoat, and had insisted on going to business when Mrs. Semple urged him to stay at home and recuperate. He was in his way a very determined person, not obstreperously so, but quietly and under the surface. Business was a great urge. He saw himself soon to be worth about $50,000. Then this cold, 9 more days of pneumonia, and he was dead. The shoe store was closed for a few days. The house was full of sympathetic friends and church people. There was a funeral, with burial service in the Callow Hill Presbyterian Church, to which they belonged, and then he was buried. Mrs. Semple cried bitterly. The shock of death affected her greatly, and left her for a time in a depressed state. A brother of hers, David Wiggin, undertook for the time being to run the shoe business for her. There was no will, but in the final adjustment, which included the sale of the shoe business, there being no desire on anybody's part to contest her right to all the property, she received over $18,000. She continued to reside in the Front Street house, and was considered a charming and interesting widow. Throughout this procedure, young Cowperwood, only 20 years of age, was quietly manifest. He called during the illness. He attended the funeral. He helped her brother, David Wiggin, dispose of the shoe business. He called once or twice after the funeral, then stayed away for a considerable time. In 5 months he reappeared, and thereafter he was a caller at stated intervals, periods of a week or 10 days. Again, it would be hard to say what he saw in Lillian Semple. Her prettiness, wax-like in its quality, fascinated him. Her indifference aroused perhaps his combative soul. He could not have explained why, but he wanted her in an urgent, passionate way. He could not think of her reasonably, and he did not talk of her much to anyone. His family knew that he went to see her, but there had grown up in the Cowperwood family a deep respect for the mental force of Frank. He was genial, cheerful, gay at most times, without being talkative, and he was decidedly successful. Everybody knew he was making money now. His salary was $50 a week, and he was certain soon to get more. Some lots of his in West Philadelphia, bought 3 years before, had increased notably in value. His streetcar holdings, augmented by still additional lots of 50 and 100 and 150 shares in New Lines Incorporated, were slowly rising, in spite of hard times, from the initial $5 in each case to $10, $15, and $25 a share, all destined to go to par. He was liked in the financial district, and he was sure that he had a successful future. Because of his analysis of the brokerage situation, he had come to the conclusion that he did not want to be a stock gambler. Instead, he was considering the matter of engaging in bill brokering, a business which he had observed to be very profitable, and which involved no risk as long as one had capital. Through his work and his father's connections, he had met many people, merchants, bankers, traders. He could get their business, or a part of it, he knew. People in Drexel and Company and Clark and Company were friendly to him. Jay Cook, a rising banking personality, was a personal friend of his. Meanwhile, he called on Mrs. Semple, and the more he called, the better he liked her. There was no exchange of brilliant ideas between them, but he had a way of being comforting and social when he wished. He advised her about her business affairs in so intelligent a way that even her relatives approved of it. She came to like him, because he was so considerate, quiet, reassuring, and so ready to explain over and over until everything was quite plain to her. She could see that he was looking on her affairs quite as if they were his own, trying to make them safe and secure. "You're so very kind, Frank," she said to him one night. "I'm awfully grateful. I don't know what I would have done if it hadn't been for you." She looked at his handsome face, which was turned to hers, with childlike simplicity.
"Not at all, not at all. I want to do it. I wouldn't have been happy if I couldn't."
His eyes had a peculiar, subtle ray in them, not a gleam. She felt warm toward him, sympathetic, quite satisfied that she could lean on him.
"Well, I am very grateful just the same. You've been so good. Come out Sunday again, if you want to, or any evening. I'll be home."
It was while he was calling on her in this way that his uncle Seneca died in Cuba and left him $15,000. This money made him worth nearly $25,000 in his own right, and he knew exactly what to do with it. A panic had come since Mr. Semple had died, which had illustrated to him very clearly what an uncertain thing the brokerage business was. There was really a severe business depression. Money was so scarce that it could fairly be said not to exist at all.
Capital, frightened by uncertain trade and money conditions everywhere, retired to its hiding places in banks, vaults, tea kettles, and stockings. The country seemed to be going to the dogs. War with the South or secession was vaguely looming up in the distance. The temper of the whole nation was nervous. People dumped their holdings on the market in order to get money. Tighe discharged three of his clerks. He cut down his expenses in every possible way and used up all his private savings to protect his private holdings. He mortgaged his house, his land holdings, everything. And in many instances, young Cowperwood was his intermediary, carrying blocks of shares to different banks to get what he could on them. "See if your father's bank won't loan me $15,000 on these," he said to Frank one day, producing a bundle of Philadelphia and Wilmington shares. Frank had heard his father speak of them in times past as excellent. "They ought to be good," the elder Cowperwood said dubiously when shown the package of securities. "At any other time they would be, but money is so tight. We find it awfully hard these days to meet our own obligations. I'll talk to Mr. Kugel." Mr. Kugel was the president. There was a long conversation, a long wait. His father came back to say it was doubtful whether they could make the loan. 8%, then being secured for money, was a small rate of interest, considering its need. For 10%, Mr. Kugel might make a call loan. Frank went back to his employer, whose commercial choler rose at the report.
"For heaven's sake, is there no money at all in the town?"
he demanded contentiously.
"Why, the interest they want is ruinous. I can't stand that. Well, take 'em back and bring me the money."
"Good God, this'll never do at all, at all!" Frank went back. "He'll pay 10%, he said quietly. Tighe was credited with a deposit of $15,000, with privilege to draw against it at once. He made out a check for the total $15,000 at once to the Girard National Bank to cover a shrinkage there. So it went. During all these days, young Cowperwood was following these financial complications with interest. He was not disturbed by the cause of slavery, or the talk of secession, or the general progress or decline of the country, except insofar as it affected his immediate interests. He longed to become a stable financier, but now that he saw the inside of the brokerage business, he was not so sure that he wanted to stay in it. Gambling in stocks, according to conditions produced by this panic, seemed very hazardous. A number of brokers failed. He saw them rush into Tighe with anguished faces and ask that certain trades be cancelled. Their very homes were in danger, they said. They would be wiped out, their wives and children put out on the street. This panic, incidentally, only made Frank more certain as to what he really wanted to do. Now that he had this free money, he would go into business for himself. Even Tighe's offer of a minor partnership failed to tempt him. "I think you have a nice business," he explained in refusing, "but I want to get in the note brokerage business for myself. I don't trust this stock game. I'd rather have a little business of my own than all the floor work in this world."
"But you're pretty young, Frank," argued his employer. "You have lots of time to work for yourself."
In the end, he parted friends with both Tighe and Rivers.
"That's a smart young fellow," observed Tighe ruefully. "He'll make his mark," rejoined Rivers. "He's the shrewdest boy of his age I ever saw."
Chapter 8 Cowperwood's world at this time was of roseate hue. He was in love and had money of his own to start his new business venture. He could take his streetcar stocks, which were steadily increasing in value, and raise 70% of their market value. He could put a mortgage on his lots and get money there, if necessary. He had established financial relations with the Girard National Bank, President Davidson there having taken a fancy to him, and he proposed to borrow from that institution some day. All he wanted was suitable investments, things in which he could realize surely, quickly. He saw fine prospective profits in the streetcar lines, which were rapidly developing into local ramifications. He purchased a horse and buggy about this time, the most attractive-looking animal and vehicle he could find. The combination cost him $500, and invited Mrs. Semple to drive with him. She refused at first, but later consented. He had told her of his success, his prospects, his windfall of $15,000, his intention of going into the note brokerage business. She knew his father was likely to succeed to the position of vice president in the Third National Bank, and she liked the Cowperwoods. Now she began to realize that there was something more than mere friendship here. This erstwhile boy was a man, and he was calling on her. It was almost ridiculous in the face of things, her seniority, her widowhood, her placid, retiring disposition, but the sheer, quiet, determined force of this young man made it plain that he was not to be balked by her sense of convention.
Cowperwood did not delude himself with any noble theories of conduct in regard to her. She was beautiful, with a mental and physical lure for him that was irresistible, and that was all he desired to know. No other woman was holding him like that. It never occurred to him that he could not or should not like other women at the same time.
There was a great deal of palaver about the sanctity of the home.
It rolled off his mental sphere like water off the feathers of a duck. He was not eager for her money, though he was well aware of it. He felt that he could use it to her advantage. He wanted her physically. He felt a keen, primitive interest in the children they would have. He wanted to find out if he could make her love him vigorously and could rout out the memory of her former life. Strange ambition. Strange perversion, one might almost say. In spite of her fears and her uncertainty, Lillian Semple accepted his attentions and interest because, equally in spite of herself, she was drawn to him. One night, when she was going to bed, she stopped in front of her dressing-table and looked at her face and her bare neck and arms. They were very pretty. A subtle something came over her as she surveyed her long, peculiarly shaded hair. She thought of young Cowperwood,
and then was chilled and shamed by the vision of the late Mr. Semple and the force and quality of public opinion.
"Why do you come to see me so often?" she asked him when he called the following evening. "Oh, don't you know?" he replied, looking at her in an interpretive way. "No."
"Sure you don't?"
"Well, I know you like Mr. Semple, and I always thought you liked me as his wife. But he's gone, though, now."
"And you're here," he replied.
"And I'm here?"
"Yes, I like you. I like to be with you. Don't you like me that way?"
"Why, I've never thought of it. You're so much younger. I'm 5 years older than you are."
"In years," he said, "certainly. That's nothing. I'm 15 years older than you are in other ways. I know more about life in some ways than you can ever hope to learn. Don't you think so?" he added softly, persuasively.
"Well, that's true. But I know a lot of things you don't know."
She laughed softly, showing her pretty teeth. It was evening. They were on the side porch. The river was before them.
"Yes, but that's only because you're a woman. A man can't hope to get a woman's point of view exactly. But I'm talking about practical affairs of this world. You're not as old that way as I am."
"Well, what of it?"
"Nothing. You asked why I came to see you. That's why."
"Partly." He relapsed into silence and stared at the water. She looked at him. His handsome body, slowly broadening, was nearly full-grown. His face, because of its full, clear, big, inscrutable eyes, had an expression which was almost babyish. She could not have guessed the depths it veiled. His cheeks were pink, his hands not large but sinewy and strong. Her pale, uncertain, lymphatic body extracted a form of dynamic energy from him, even at this range.
"I don't think you ought to come to see me so often. People won't think well of it."
She ventured to take a distant, matronly air, the air she had originally held toward him. "People," he said, "don't worry about people. People think what you want them to think. I wish you wouldn't take that distant air toward me."
"Why?" "Because I like you." "But you mustn't like me. It's wrong. I can't ever marry you. You're too young. I'm too old."
"Don't say that," he said imperiously.
"There's nothing to it. I want you to marry me. You know I do. Now when will it be?" "Why, how silly. I never heard of such a thing," she exclaimed. "It will never be, Frank. It can't be."
"Why can't it?" he asked.
"Because, well, because I'm older. People would think it strange. I'm not long enough free."
"Oh, long enough nothing!" he exclaimed irritably. "That's the one thing I have against you. You are so worried about what people think. They don't make your life, and they certainly don't make mine. Think of yourself first. You have your own life to make. Are you going to let what other people think stand in the way of what you want to do?"
"But I don't want to," she smiled.
He arose and came over to her, looking into her eyes.
"Well?"
she asked, nervously, quizzically. He merely looked at her.
"Well?"
she queried, more flustered. He stooped down to take her arms, but she got up.
"Now you must not come near me," she pleaded, determinedly. "I'll go in the house, and I'll not let you come any more. It's terrible. You're silly. You mustn't interest yourself in me."
She did show a good deal of determination, and he desisted. But for the time being only. He called again and again. Then one night, when they had gone inside because of the mosquitoes, and when she had insisted that he must stop coming to see her, that his attentions were noticeable to others, and that she would be disgraced, he caught her, under desperate protest, in his arms.
"Now see here," she exclaimed, "I told you it's silly. You mustn't kiss me. How dare you? Oh,
Oh, oh!
She broke away and ran up the nearby stairway to her room. Cowperwood followed her swiftly. As she pushed the door to, he forced it open and recaptured her. He lifted her bodily from her feet and held her crosswise, lying in his arms.
"Oh, how could you?" she exclaimed. "I will never speak to you any more. I will never let you come here any more if you don't put me down this minute. Put me down!"
"I'll put you down, sweet," he said. "I'll take you down," at the same time pulling her face to him and kissing her. He was very much aroused, excited. While she was twisting and protesting, he carried her down the stairs again into the living room and seated himself in the great armchair, still holding her tight in his arms.
"Oh,"
she sighed, falling limp on his shoulder when he refused to let her go. Then, because of the set determination of his face, some intense pull in him, she smiled.
"How would I ever explain if I did marry you?"
she asked weakly.
"Your father, your mother."
"You don't need to explain. I'll do that. And you needn't worry about my family. They won't care."
"But mine," she recoiled.
"Don't worry about yours. I'm not marrying your family. I'm marrying you. We have independent means." She relapsed into additional protests, but he kissed her the more. There was a deadly persuasion to his caresses. Mr. Semple had never displayed any such fire. He aroused a force of feeling in her which had not previously been there. She was afraid of it and ashamed. "Will you marry me in a month?" he asked, cheerfully, when she paused.
"You know I won't," she exclaimed nervously. "The idea! Why do you ask?
What difference does it make? We're going to get married eventually." He was thinking how attractive he could make her look in other surroundings. Neither she nor his family knew how to live.
"Well, not in a month. Wait a little while. I will marry you after a while, after you see whether you want me."
He caught her tight. "I'll show you," he said.
"Please stop. You hurt me."
"How about it? 2 months?"
"Certainly not."
"3?
"Well, maybe."
"No maybe in that case. We marry."
"But you're only a boy."
"Don't worry about me. You'll find out how much of a boy I am." He seemed of a sudden to open up a new world to her, and she realized that she had never really lived before. This man represented something bigger and stronger than ever her husband had dreamed of. In his young way, he was terrible, irresistible.
"Well, in 3 months, then,"
she whispered, while he rocked her cozily in his arms. Chapter 9 Cowperwood started in the note brokerage business with a small office at No. 64 South 3rd Street, where he very soon had the pleasure of discovering that his former excellent business connections remembered him. He would go to one house, where he suspected ready money might be desirable, and offer to negotiate their notes or any paper they might issue, bearing 6% interest, for a commission, and then he would sell the paper for a small commission to someone who would welcome a secure investment. Sometimes his father, sometimes other people, helped him with suggestions as to when and how. Between the two ends, he might make 4% and 5% on the total transaction. In the first year, he cleared $6,000 over and above all expenses. That wasn't much, but he was augmenting it in another way, which he believed would bring great profit in the future. Before the first streetcar line, which was a shambling affair, had been laid on Front Street, the streets of Philadelphia had been crowded with hundreds of springless omnibuses rattling over rough, hard cobblestones. Now, thanks to the idea of John Stevenson in New York, the double-rail track idea had come, and besides the line on 5th and 6th Streets, the cars running out one street and back on another, which had paid splendidly from the start, there were many other lines proposed or underway. The city was as eager to see streetcars replace omnibuses as it was to see railroads replace canals. There was opposition, of course. There always is in such cases. The cry of probable monopoly was raised. Disgruntled and defeated omnibus owners and drivers groaned aloud. Cowperwood had implicit faith in the future of the street railway. In support of this belief, he risked all he could spare on new issues of stock shares in new companies. He wanted to be on the inside wherever possible, always, though this was a little difficult in the matter of the street railways, he having been so young when they started, and not having yet arranged his financial connections to make them count for much. The 5th and 6th Street line, which had been but recently started, was paying $600 a day. A project for a West Philadelphia line, Walnut and Chestnut, was on foot, as were lines to occupy 2nd and 3rd Streets, Race and Vine, Spruce and Pine, Green and Coates, 10th and 11th, and so forth.
They were engineered and backed by some powerful capitalists who had influence with the state legislature and could, in spite of great public protest, obtain franchises. Charges of corruption were in the air. It was argued that the streets were valuable and that the companies should pay a road tax of $1,000 a mile. Somehow, however, these splendid grants were gotten through, and the public, hearing of the 5th and 6th Street line profits, was eager to invest. Cowperwood was one of these, and when the 2nd and 3rd Street line was engineered, he invested in that and in the Walnut and Chestnut Street line also. He began to have vague dreams of controlling a line himself some day, but as yet he did not see exactly how it was to be done, since his business was far from being a bonanza. In the midst of this early work, he married Mrs. Semple. There was no vast to-do about it, as he did not want any, and his bride-to-be was nervous, fearsome of public opinion. His family did not entirely approve. She was too old, his mother and father thought, and then Frank, with his prospects, could have done much better. His sister Anna fancied that Mrs. Semple was designing, which was, of course, not true. His brothers, Joseph and Edward, were interested, but not certain as to what they actually thought, since Mrs. Semple was good-looking and had some money. It was a warm October day when he and Lillian went to the altar in the First Presbyterian Church of Callowhill Street. His bride, Frank was satisfied, looked exquisite in a trailing gown of cream lace, a creation that had cost months of labor. His parents, Mrs. Seneca Davis, the Wigan family, brothers and sisters, and some friends were present. He was a little opposed to this idea, but Lillian wanted it. He stood up straight and correct in black broadcloth for the wedding ceremony, because she wished it, but later changed to a smart business suit for traveling. He had arranged his affairs for a 2 weeks trip to New York and Boston. They took an afternoon train for New York, which required 5 hours to reach. When they were finally alone in the Astor House, New York, after hours of make-believe and public pretense of indifference, he gathered her in his arms. "Oh, it's delicious," he exclaimed, "to have you all to myself." She met his eagerness with that smiling, tantalizing passivity which he had so much admired, but which this time was tinged strongly with a communicated desire. He thought he should never have enough of her beautiful face, her lovely arms, her smooth, lymphatic body. They were like two children, billing and cooing, driving, dining, seeing the sights. He was curious to visit the financial sections of both cities. New York and Boston appealed to him as commercially solid. He wondered, as he observed the former, whether he should ever leave Philadelphia. He was going to be very happy there now, he thought, with Lillian and possibly a brood of young Cowperwoods. He was going to work hard and make money. With his means and hers now at his command, he might become, very readily, notably wealthy. Chapter 10 The home atmosphere which they established when they returned from their honeymoon was a great improvement in taste over that which had characterized the earlier life of Mrs. Cowperwood as Mrs. Semple. They had decided to occupy her house on North Front Street, for a while at least.
Cowperwood, aggressive in his current artistic mood, had objected at once after they were engaged to the spirit of the furniture and decorations, or lack of them, and had suggested that he be allowed to have it brought more in keeping with his idea of what was appropriate.
During the years in which he had been growing into manhood, he had come instinctively into sound notions of what was artistic and refined. He had seen so many homes that were more distinguished and harmonious than his own. One could not walk or drive about Philadelphia without seeing and being impressed with the general tendency toward a more cultivated and selective social life. Many excellent and expensive houses were being erected. The front lawn, with some attempt at floral gardening, was achieving local popularity. In the homes of the Tighes, the Lees, Arthur Rivers, and others, he had noticed art objects of some distinction. Bronzes, marbles, hangings, pictures, clocks, rugs. It seemed to him now that his comparatively commonplace house could be made into something charming, and for comparatively little money. The dining room, for instance, which, through two plain windows set in a flat side wall back of the veranda, looked south over a stretch of grass and several trees and bushes, to a dividing fence where the Semple property ended and a neighbor's began, could be made so much more attractive. That fence, sharp-pointed, gray palings, could be torn away and a hedge put in its place. The wall which divided the dining room from the parlor could be knocked through, and a hanging of some pleasing character put in its place. A bay window could be built to replace the two present oblong windows, a bay which would come down to the floor and open out on the lawn via swiveled diamond-shaped lead-paned frames. All this shabby, nondescript furniture, collected from heaven knows where,
partly inherited from the Semples and the Wiggins and partly bought, could be thrown out or sold, and something better and more harmonious introduced. He knew a young man by the name of Ellsworth, an architect newly graduated from a local school, with whom he had struck up an interesting friendship, one of those inexplicable inclinations of temperament. Wilton Ellsworth was an artist in spirit, quiet, meditative, refined. From discussing the quality of a certain building on Chestnut Street, which was then being erected, and which Ellsworth pronounced atrocious, they had fallen to discussing art in general, or the lack of it, in America. And it occurred to him that Ellsworth was the man to carry out his decorative views to a nicety. When he suggested the young man to Lillian, she placidly agreed with him, and also with his own ideas of how the house could be revised. So while they were gone on their honeymoon, Ellsworth began the revision on an estimated cost of $3,000, including the furniture. It was not completed for nearly 3 weeks after their return, but when finished, made a comparatively new house. The dining room bay hung low over the grass, as Frank wished, and the windows were diamond-paned and leaded, swiveled on brass rods. The parlor and dining room were separated by sliding doors, but the intention was to hang in this opening a silk hanging depicting a wedding scene in Normandy. Old English oak was used in the dining room, an American imitation of Chippendale and Sheraton for the sitting room and the bedrooms. There were a few simple watercolors hung here and there, some bronzes of Hosmer and Powers, a marble Venus by Potter, a now-forgotten sculptor, and other objects of art, nothing of any distinction. Pleasing, appropriately colored rugs covered the floor. Mrs. Cowperwood was shocked by the nudity of the Venus, which conveyed an atmosphere of European freedom not common to America. But she said nothing. It was all harmonious and soothing, and she did not feel herself capable to judge. Frank knew about these things so much better than she did. Then, with a maid and a man of all work installed, a program of entertaining was begun on a small scale. Those who recall the early years of their married life can best realize the subtle changes which this new condition brought to Frank, for, like all who accept the hymeneal yoke, he was influenced to a certain extent by the things with which he surrounded himself. Primarily, from certain traits of his character, one would have imagined him called to be a citizen of eminent respectability and worth. He appeared to be an ideal home man. He delighted to return to his wife in the evenings, leaving the crowded downtown section where traffic clamored and men hurried. Here he could feel that he was well stationed and physically happy in life. The thought of the dinner table with candles upon it, his idea. The thought of Lillian in a trailing gown of pale blue or green silk, he liked her in those colors. The thought of a large fireplace flaming with solid lengths of cordwood, and Lillian snuggling in his arms, gripped his immature imagination. As has been said before, he cared nothing for books but life. Pictures, trees, physical contact, these, in spite of his shrewd and already gripping financial calculations, held him. To live richly, joyously, fully, his whole nature craved that. And Mrs. Cowperwood, in spite of the difference in their years, appeared to be a fit mate for him at this time. She was once awakened, and, for the time being, clinging, responsive, dreamy. His mood and hers was for a baby, and in a little while that happy expectation was whispered to him by her. She had half fancied that her previous barrenness was due to herself, and was rather surprised and delighted at the proof that it was not so. It opened new possibilities, a seemingly glorious future of which she was not afraid. He liked it, the idea of self-duplication. It was almost acquisitive, this thought. For days and weeks and months and years, at least the first 4 or 5, he took a keen satisfaction in coming home evenings, strolling about the yard, driving with his wife, having friends in to dinner, talking over with her in an exemplary way the things he intended to do. She did not understand his financial abstrusities, and he did not trouble to make them clear. But love, her pretty body, her lips, her quiet manner, the lure of all these combined, and his 2 children, when they came, 2 in 4 years, held him. He would dandle Frank Jr., who was the first to arrive, on his knee, looking at his chubby feet, his kindling eyes, his almost formless yet bud-like mouth, and wonder at the process by which children came into the world. There was so much to think of in this connection, the spermatozoic beginning, the strange period of gestation in women, the danger of disease and delivery. He had gone through a real period of strain when Frank Jr. was born, for Mrs. Cowperwood was frightened. He feared for the beauty of her body, troubled over the danger of losing her, and he actually endured his first worry when he stood outside the door the day the child came.
Not much. He was too self-sufficient, too resourceful. And yet he worried, conjuring up thoughts of death and the end of their present state. Then word came, after certain piercing, harrowing cries, that all was well, and he was permitted to look at the new arrival. The experience broadened his conception of things, made him more solid in his judgment of life. That old conviction of tragedy underlying the surface of things, like wood under its veneer, was emphasized.
Little Frank, and later Lillian, blue-eyed and golden-haired, touched his imagination for a while.
There was a good deal to this home idea, after all. That was the way life was organized, and properly so. Its cornerstone was the home. It would be impossible to indicate fully how subtle were the material changes which these years involved, changes so gradual that they were, like the lap of soft waters, unnoticeable. Considerable, a great deal, considering how little he had to begin with, wealth was added in the next 5 years. He came, in his financial world, to know fairly intimately, as commercial relationships go, some of the subtlest characters of the steadily enlarging financial world. In his days at Tighe's and on the exchange, many curious figures had been pointed out to him. State and city officials of one grade and another who were making something out of politics, and some national figures who came from Washington to Philadelphia at times to see Drexel and Company, Clark and Company, and even Tighe and Company. These men, as he learned, had tips or advance news of legislative or economic changes which were sure to affect certain stocks or trade opportunities. A young clerk had once pulled his sleeve at Tighe's.
"See that man going to see Tighe?"
"Yes."
"That's Murta, the city treasurer. Say, he don't do anything but play a fine game. All that money to invest, and he don't have to account for anything except the principal. The interest goes to him."
Cowperwood understood. All these city and state officials speculated. They had a habit of depositing city and state funds with certain bankers and brokers as authorized agents or designated state depositories. The banks paid no interest, save to the officials personally. They loaned it to certain brokers on the officials' secret order, and the latter invested it in sure winners. The bankers got the free use of the money a part of the time, the brokers another part. The officials made money, and the brokers received a fat commission. There was a political ring in Philadelphia in which the mayor, certain members of the council, the treasurer, the chief of police, the commissioner of public works, and others shared. It was a case, generally, of, "You scratch my back, and I'll scratch yours." Cowperwood thought it rather shabby work at first, but many men were rapidly getting rich, and no one seemed to care. The newspapers were always talking about civic patriotism and pride, but never a word about these things, and the men who did them were powerful and respected. There were many houses, a constantly widening circle, that found him a very trustworthy agent in disposing of note issues or note payment. He seemed to know so quickly where to go to get the money. From the first he made it a principle to keep $20,000 in cash on hand in order to be able to take up a proposition instantly and without discussion. So often as he was able to say, "Why, certainly, I could do that," when otherwise, on the face of things, he would not have been able to do so. He was asked if he would not handle certain stock transactions on change. He had no seat, and he intended not to take any at first. But now he changed his mind and bought one, not only in Philadelphia, but in New York also. A certain Joseph Zimmerman, a dry-goods man, for whom he had handled various note issues, suggested that he undertake operating in street railway shares for him, and this was the beginning of his return to the floor. In the meanwhile, his family life was changing, growing, one might have said, finer and more secure. Mrs. Cowperwood had, for instance, been compelled from time to time to make a subtle readjustment of her personal relationship with people, as he had with his. When Mr. Semple was alive, she had been socially connected with tradesmen principally, retailers and small wholesalers, a very few. Some of the women of her own church, the First Presbyterian, were friendly with her.
There had been church teas and sociables which she and Mr. Semple attended, and dull visits to his relatives and hers.
The Cowperwoods, the Watermans, and a few families of that caliber had been the notable exceptions. Now all this was changed. Young Cowperwood did not care very much for her relatives, and the Semples had been alienated by her second, and to them outrageous, marriage. His own family was closely interested by ties of affection and mutual prosperity, but, better than this, he was drawing to himself some really significant personalities. He brought home with him socially, not to talk business, for he disliked that idea. Bankers, investors, customers, and prospective customers. Out on the Schuylkill, the Wissahickon, and elsewhere, were popular dining places where one could drive on Sunday.
He and Mrs. Cowperwood frequently drove out to Mrs. Seneca Davis's, to Judge Kitchen's, to the home of Andrew Sharpless, a lawyer whom he knew, to the home of Harper Steger, his own lawyer, and others. Cowperwood had the gift of geniality. None of these men or women suspected the depth of his nature. He was thinking, 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 but enjoyed life as he went. One of his earliest and most genuine leanings was toward paintings. He admired nature, but somehow, without knowing why, he fancied one could best grasp it through the personality of some interpreter, just as we gain our ideas of law and politics through individuals. Mrs. Cowperwood cared not a whit one way or another, but she accompanied him to exhibitions, thinking all the while that Frank was a little peculiar. He tried, because he loved her, to interest her in these things intelligently, but while she pretended slightly, she could not really see or care, and it was very plain that she could not. The children took up a great deal of her time. However, Cowperwood was not troubled about this. It struck him as delightful and exceedingly worthwhile that she should be so devoted. At the same time, her lethargic manner, vague smile, and her sometimes seeming indifference, which sprang largely from a sense of absolute security, attracted him also. She was so different from him. She took her second marriage quite as she had taken her first, a solemn fact which contained no possibility of mental alteration. As for himself, however, he was bustling about in a world which, financially at least, seemed all alteration. There were so many sudden and almost unheard-of changes. He began to look at her at times with a speculative eye, not very critically, for he liked her, but with an attempt to weigh her personality. He had known her 5 years and more now. What did he know about her? The vigor of youth, those first years, had made up for so many things, but now that he had her safely. There came in this period the slow approach and finally the declaration of war between the North and the South, attended with so much excitement that almost all current minds were notably colored by it. It was terrific. Then came meetings, public and stirring, and riots. The incident of John Brown's body, the arrival of Lincoln, the great commoner on his way from Springfield, Illinois, to Washington via Philadelphia to take the oath of office, the Battle of Bull Run, the Battle of Vicksburg, the Battle of Gettysburg, and so on. Cowperwood was only 25 at the time, a cool, determined youth, who thought the slave agitation might be well-founded in human rights, no doubt was, but exceedingly dangerous to trade. He hoped the North would win, but it might go hard with him personally and other financiers. He did not care to fight. That seemed silly for the individual man to do. Others might. There were many poor, thin-minded, half-baked creatures who would put themselves up to be shot, but they were only fit to be commanded or shot down. As for him, his life was sacred to himself and his family and his personal interests. He recalled seeing, one day, in one of the quiet side streets, as the working men were coming home from their work, a small enlisting squad of soldiers in blue marching enthusiastically along, the Union flag flying, the drummers drumming, the fifes blowing, the idea being, of course, to so impress the hitherto indifferent or wavering citizen, to exalt him to such a pitch that he would lose his sense of proportion, of self-interest, and forgetting all—wife, parents, home, and children—and seeing only the great need of the country, fall in behind and enlist. He saw one working man swinging his pail, and evidently not contemplating any such denouement to his day's work, pause, listen as the squad approached, hesitate as it drew close, and as it passed, with a peculiar look of uncertainty or wonder in his eyes, fall in behind and march solemnly away to the enlisting quarters. What was it that had caught this man? Frank asked himself. How was he overcome so easily? He had not intended to go. His face was streaked with the grease and dirt of his work. He looked like a foundry man or machinist, say 25 years of age. Frank watched the little squad disappear at the end of the street round the corner under the trees. This current war spirit was strange. The people seemed to want to hear nothing but the sound of the drum and fife, to see nothing but troops, of which there were thousands now passing through on their way to the front, carrying cold steel in the shape of guns at their shoulders, to hear of war and the rumors of war. It was a thrilling sentiment, no doubt, great but unprofitable. It meant self-sacrifice, and he could not see that. If he went, he might be shot, and what would his noble emotion amount to then? He would rather make money, regulate current political, social, and financial affairs. The poor fool who fell in behind the enlisting squad—no, not fool, you would not call him that—the poor, overwrought working man. Well, heaven pity him. Heaven pity all of them. They really did not know what they were doing.
One day he saw Lincoln, a tall, shambling man, long, bony, gawky, but tremendously impressive. It was a raw, slushy morning of a late February day, and the great war president was just through with his solemn pronunciamento in regard to the bonds that might have been strained, but must not be broken. As he issued from the doorway of Independence Hall, that famous birthplace of liberty, his face was set in a sad, meditative calm. Cowperwood looked at him fixedly as he issued from the doorway surrounded by chiefs of staff, local dignitaries, detectives, and the curious, sympathetic faces of the public. As he studied the strangely rough-hewn countenance, a sense of the great worth and dignity of the man came over him. A real man, that, he thought. A wonderful temperament. His every gesture came upon him with great force. He watched him enter his carriage, thinking, "So that is the rail-splitter, the country lawyer. Well, fate has picked a great man for this crisis." For days the face of Lincoln haunted him, and very often during the war his mind reverted to that singular figure. It seemed to him unquestionable that, fortuitously, he had been permitted to look upon one of the world's really great men. War and statesmanship were not for him, but he knew how important those things were, at times. Chapter 11. It was while the war was on, and after it was perfectly plain that it was not to be of a few days' duration, that Cowperwood's first great financial opportunity came to him. There was a strong demand for money at the time on the part of the nation, the state, and the city. In July 1861, Congress had authorized a loan of $50 million, to be secured by 20-year bonds with interest not to exceed 7%, and the state authorized a loan of $3 million on much the same security, the first being handled by financiers of Boston, New York, and Philadelphia, the second by Philadelphia financiers alone. Cowperwood had no hand in this. He was not big enough. He read in the papers of gatherings of men whom he knew personally or by reputation to consider the best way to aid the nation or the state. But he was not included. And yet his soul yearned to be of them. He noticed how often a rich man's word sufficed. No money, no certificates, no collateral, no anything, just his word. If Drexel & Company, or J. Cook & Company, or Gould & Fisk were rumored to be behind anything, how secure it was. J. Cook, a young man in Philadelphia, had made a great strike taking this state loan in company with Drexel & Company and selling it at par. The general opinion was that it ought to be and could only be sold at 90. Cook did not believe this. He believed that state pride and state patriotism would warrant offering the loan to small banks and private citizens, and that they would subscribe it fully and more. Events justified Cook magnificently, and his public reputation was assured. Cowperwood wished he could make some such strike, but he was too practical to worry over anything save the facts and conditions that were before him. His chance came about 6 months later, when it was found that the state would have to have much more money. Its quota of troops would have to be equipped and paid. There were measures of defense to be taken, the treasury to be replenished. A call for a loan of $23 million was finally authorized by the legislature and issued. There was great talk in the street as to who was to handle it. Drexel & Company and J. Cook & Company, of course. Cowperwood pondered over this. If he could handle a fraction of this great loan now, he could not possibly handle the whole of it, for he had not the necessary connections. He could add considerably to his reputation as a broker while making a tidy sum. How much could he handle? That was the question. Who would take portions of it? His father's bank? Probably. Waterman & Company? A little. Judge Kitchen? A small fraction. The Mills David Company? Yes. He thought of different individuals and concerns who, for one reason and another—personal friendship, good nature, gratitude for past favors, and so on—would take a percentage of the 7% bonds through him. He totaled up his possibilities and discovered that in all likelihood, with a little preliminary missionary work, he could dispose of $1 million if personal influence, through local political figures, could bring this much of the loan his way. One man in particular had grown strong in his estimation as having some subtle political connection not visible on the surface, and this was Edward Malia Butler. Butler was a contractor, undertaking the construction of sewers, water mains, foundations for buildings, street paving, and the like. In the early days, long before Cowperwood had known him, he had been a garbage contractor on his own account. The city at that time had no extended street cleaning service, particularly in the outlying sections, and some of the older, poorer regions. Edward Butler, then a poor young Irishman, had begun by collecting and hauling away the garbage free of charge and feeding it to his pigs and cattle.
Later he discovered that some people were willing to pay a small charge for this service. Then a local political character, a councilman friend of his, they were both Catholics, saw a new point in the whole thing. Butler could be made official garbage collector. The council could vote an annual appropriation for this service. Butler could employ more wagons than he did now, dozens of them, scores. Not only that, but no other garbage collector would be allowed. There were others, but the official contract awarded him would also officially be the end of the life of any and every disturbing rival. A certain amount of the profitable proceeds would have to be set aside to assuage the feelings of those who were not contractors. Funds would have to be loaned at election time to certain individuals and organizations, but no matter. The amount would be small. So Butler and Patrick Gavin Comiskey, the councilman, the latter silently, entered into business relations. Butler gave up driving a wagon himself. He hired a young man, a smart Irish boy of his neighborhood, Jimmy Sheehan, to be his assistant, superintendent, stableman, bookkeeper, and whatnot. Since he soon began to make between $4,000 and $5,000 a year, where before he made $2,000, he moved into a brick house in an outlying section of the South Side and sent his children to school. Mrs. Butler gave up making soap and feeding pigs, and since then times have been exceedingly good with Edward Butler. He could neither read nor write at first, but now he knew how, of course. He had learned from association with Mr. Comiskey that there were other forms of contracting, sewers, water mains, gas mains, street paving, and the like. Who better than Edward Butler to do it? He knew the councilmen, many of them. He met them in the back rooms of saloons, on Sundays and Saturdays at political picnics, at election councils and conferences, for as a beneficiary of the city's largesse, he was expected to contribute not only money, but advice. Curiously, he had developed a strange political wisdom. He knew a successful man or a coming man when he saw one. So many of his bookkeepers, superintendents, timekeepers had graduated into councilmen and state legislators. His nominees, suggested to political conferences, were so often known to make good. First he came to have influence in his councilman's ward, then in his legislative district, then in the city councils of his party, Whig, of course, and then he was supposed to have an organization. Mysterious forces worked for him in council. He was awarded significant contracts, and he always bid. The garbage business was now a thing of the past. His eldest boy, Owen, was a member of the state legislature and a partner in his business affairs. His second son, Callum, was a clerk in the city water department and an assistant to his father also. Eileen, his eldest daughter, 15 years of age, was still in St. Agatha's, a convent school in Germantown. Nora, his second daughter and youngest child, 13 years old, was in attendance at a local private school conducted by a Catholic sisterhood. The Butler family had moved away from South Philadelphia into Girard Avenue, near the 1200s, where a new and rather interesting social life was beginning.
They were not of it, but Edward Butler, contractor, now 55 years of age, worth, say, $500,000, had many political and financial friends.
No longer a rough neck, but a solid, reddish-faced man, slightly tanned, with broad shoulders and a solid chest, gray eyes, gray hair, a typically Irish face made wise and calm and undecipherable by much experience. His big hands and feet indicated a day when he had not worn the best English cloth suits and tanned leather, but his presence was not in any way offensive, rather the other way about. Though still possessed of a brogue, he was soft-spoken, winning, and persuasive. He had been one of the first to become interested in the development of the streetcar system and had come to the conclusion, as had Cowperwood and many others, that it was going to be a great thing. The money returns on the stocks or shares he had been induced to buy had been ample evidence of that. He had dealt through one broker and another, having failed to get in on the original corporate organizations. He wanted to pick up such stock as he could in one organization and another, for he believed they all had a future, and most of all, he wanted to get control of a line or two. In connection with this idea, he was looking for some reliable young man, honest and capable, who would work under his direction and do what he said. Then he learned of Cowperwood, and one day sent for him and asked him to call at his house. Cowperwood responded quickly, for he knew of Butler, his rise, his connections, his force. He called at the house as directed one cold, crisp February morning. He remembered the appearance of the street afterward, broad, brick-paved sidewalks, macadamized roadway, powdered over with a light snow and set with young, leafless, scrubby trees and lamp-posts. Butler's house was not new. He had bought and repaired it, but it was not an unsatisfactory specimen of the architecture of the time.
It was 50 feet wide, 4 stories tall, of gray stone, and with 4 wide white stone steps leading up to the door. The window arches, framed in white, had U-shaped keystones. There were curtains of lace and a glimpse of red plush through the windows, which gleamed warm against the cold and snow outside. A trim Irish maid came to the door, and he gave her his card and was invited into the house. "Is Mr. Butler home?"
"I'm not sure, sir. I'll find out. He may have gone out."
In a little while he was asked to come upstairs, where he found Butler in a somewhat commercial-looking room. It had a desk, an office chair, some leather furnishings, and a bookcase, but no completeness or symmetry as either an office or a living room. There were several pictures on the wall, an impossible oil painting, for one thing dark and gloomy, a canal and barge scene in pink and Nile green for another, some daguerreotypes of relatives and friends, which were not half bad. Cowperwood noticed one of 2 girls, one with reddish-gold hair, another with what appeared to be silky brown. The beautiful silver effect of the daguerreotype had been tinted. They were pretty girls, healthy, smiling, Celtic, their heads close together, their eyes looking straight out at you. He admired them casually, and fancied they must be Butler's daughters.
"Mr. Cowperwood?"
inquired Butler, uttering the name fully with a peculiar accent on the vowels. He was a slow-moving man, solemn and deliberate. Cowperwood noticed that his body was hale and strong, like seasoned hickory, tanned by wind and rain. The flesh of his cheeks was pulled taut, and there was nothing soft or flabby about him. "I'm that man."
"I have a little matter of stocks to talk over with you."
Matter almost sounded like mother.
"And I thought you'd better come here rather than I should come down to your office. We can be more private-like, and besides, I'm not as young as I used to be."
He allowed a semi-twinkle to rest in his eye as he looked his visitor over. Cowperwood smiled. "Well, I hope I can be of service to you," he said genially.
"I happen to be interested just at present in picking up certain street railway stocks on change. I'll tell you about them later. Won't you have something to drink? It's a cold morning."
"No, thanks. I never drink."
"Never? Well, that's a hard word when it comes to whiskey. Well, no matter. It's a good rule. My boys don't touch anything, and I'm glad of it. As I say, I'm interested in picking up a few stocks on change, but to tell you the truth, I'm more interested in finding some clever young fellow like yourself, through whom I can work. One thing leads to another, you know, in this world,"
and he looked at his visitor non-committedly, and yet with a genial show of interest.
"Quite so," replied Cowperwood, with a friendly gleam in return. "Well,"
Butler meditated, half to himself, half to Cowperwood,
"there are a number of things that a bright young man could do for me in the street if he were so minded. I have 2 bright boys of my own, but I don't want them to become stock gamblers, and I don't know that they would or could if I wanted them to. But this isn't a matter of stock gambling. I'm pretty busy as it is, and as I said a while ago, I'm getting along. I'm not as light on my toes as I once was, but if I had the right sort of young man— I've been looking into your record, by the way, never fear— he might handle a number of little things, investments and loans, which might bring us each a little something. Sometimes the young men around town ask advice of me in one way or another. They have a little something to invest, and so—"
He paused and looked tantalizingly out of the window, knowing full well Cowperwood was greatly interested, and that this talk of political influence and connections could only whet his appetite. Butler wanted him to see clearly that fidelity was the point in this case. Fidelity, tact, subtlety, and concealment.
"Well, if you have been looking into my record," observed Cowperwood with his own elusive smile, leaving the thought suspended.
Butler felt the force of the temperament and the argument. He liked the young man's poise and balance. A number of people had spoken of Cowperwood to him. It was now Cowperwood and Company. The company was fiction purely. He asked him something about the street, how the market was running, what he knew about street railways. Finally, he outlined his plan of buying all he could of the stock of 2 given lines, the 9th and 10th, and the 15th and 16th, without attracting any attention, if possible. It was to be done slowly, part on change, part from individual holders. He did not tell him that there was a certain amount of legislative pressure he hoped to bring to bear to get him franchises for extensions in the regions beyond where the lines now ended, in order that when the time came for them to extend their facilities, they would have to see him or his sons, who might be large minority stockholders in these very concerns. It was a far-sighted plan, and meant that the lines would eventually drop into his or his son's basket. "I'll be delighted to work with you, Mr. Butler, in any way that you may suggest,"
observed Cowperwood. I can't say that I have so much of a business as yet, merely prospects, but my connections are good. I am now a member of the New York and Philadelphia exchanges. Those who have dealt with me seem to like the results I get.
I know a little something about your work already, reiterated Butler, wisely.
Very well, then. Whenever you have a commission, you can call at my office, or write, or I will call here. I will give you my secret operating code, so that anything you say will be strictly confidential.
Well, we'll not say anything more now. In a few days, I'll have something for you. When I do, you can draw on my bank for what you need, up to a certain amount.
He got up and looked out into the street, and Cowperwood also arose.
It's a fine day now, isn't it?
It surely is.
Well, we'll get to know each other better, I'm sure.
He held out his hand.
I hope so.
Cowperwood went out, Butler accompanying him to the door. As he did so, a young girl bounded in from the street, red-cheeked, blue-eyed, wearing a scarlet cape with a peaked hood thrown over her red-gold hair.
"Oh, Daddy, I almost knocked you down."
She gave her father, and incidentally Cowperwood, a gleaming, radiant, inclusive smile. Her teeth were bright and small, and her lips bud-red.
"You're home early. I thought you were going to stay all day."
"I was, but I changed my mind."
She passed on in, swinging her arms.
"Yes, well," Butler continued when she had gone, "then we'll leave it for a day or two. Good day."
"Good day." Cowperwood, warm with this enhancing of his financial prospects, went down the steps, but incidentally he spared a passing thought for the gay spirit of youth that had manifested itself in this red-cheeked maiden. What a bright, healthy, bounding girl! Her voice had the subtle, vigorous ring of 15 or 16. She was all vitality. What a fine catch for some young fellow some day, and her father would make him rich, no doubt, or help to.
Chapter 12
It was to Edward Malia Butler that Cowperwood turned now, some 19 months later, when he was thinking of the influence that might bring him an award of a portion of the state issue of bonds. Butler could probably be interested to take some of them himself, or could help him place some. He had come to like Cowperwood very much, and was now being carried on the latter's books as a prospective purchaser of large blocks of stocks. And Cowperwood liked this great, solid Irishman. He liked his history. He had met Mrs. Butler, a rather fat and phlegmatic Irishwoman, with a world of hard sense, who cared nothing at all for show, and who still liked to go into the kitchen and superintend the cooking. He had met Owen and Callum Butler, the boys, and Eileen and Nora, the girls. Eileen was the one who had bounded up the steps the first day he had called at the Butler house several seasons before. There was a cozy grate fire burning in Butler's improvised private office when Cowperwood called. Spring was coming on, but the evenings were cool. The older man invited Cowperwood to make himself comfortable in one of the large leather chairs before the fire, and then proceeded to listen to his recital of what he hoped to accomplish.
"Well, now, that isn't so easy," he commented at the end. "You ought to know more about that than I do. I'm not a financier, as you well know," and he grinned apologetically.
"It's a matter of influence," went on Cowperwood, "and favoritism. That I know. Drexel & Company and Cook & Company have connections at Harrisburg. They have men of their own looking after their interests. The Attorney General and the State Treasurer are hand in glove with them. Even if I put in a bid and can demonstrate that I can handle the loan, it won't help me to get it. Other people have done that. I have to have friends, influence. You know how it is."
"Them things," Butler said, "is easy enough if you know the right parties to approach. Now there's Jimmy Oliver. He ought to know something about that."
Jimmy Oliver was the whilom district attorney serving at this time, and incidentally free adviser to Mr. Butler in many ways. He was also, accidentally, a warm personal friend of the state treasurer.
"How much of the loan do you want?"
$5 million.
$5 million? Butler sat up. "Man, what are you talking about? That's a good deal of money. Where are you going to sell all that?"
"I want to bid for $5 million," assuaged Cowperwood softly. "I only want $1 million, but I want the prestige of putting in a bona fide bid for $5 million. It will do me good on the street." Butler sank back somewhat relieved.
$5 million. Prestige. You want $1 million. Well, now, that's different. That's not such a bad idea. We ought to be able to get that."
He rubbed his chin some more and stared into the fire. And Cowperwood felt confident when he left the house that evening that Butler would not fail him, but would set the wheels working. Therefore, he was not surprised and knew exactly what it meant when a few days later he was introduced to City Treasurer Julian Bode, who promised to introduce him to State Treasurer Van Nordstrand and to see that his claims of consideration were put before the people. "Of course you know," he said to Cowperwood in the presence of Butler, for it was at the latter's home that the conference took place. "This banking crowd is very powerful. You know who they are. They don't want any interference in this bond-issue business. I was talking to Terence Relihan, who represents them up there, meaning Harrisburg, the state capital, and he says they won't stand for it at all. You may have trouble right here in Philadelphia after you get it. They're pretty powerful, you know. Are you sure just where you can place it?"
"Yes, I'm sure," replied Cowperwood.
"Well, the best thing in my judgment is not to say anything at all. Just put in your bid. Van Nordstrand, with the governor's approval, will make the award. We can fix the governor, I think. After you get it, they may talk to you personally, but that's your business."
Cowperwood smiled his inscrutable smile. There were so many ins and outs to this financial life. It was an endless network of underground holes, along which all sorts of influences were moving. A little wit, a little nimbleness, a little luck, time and opportunity, these sometimes availed. Here he was, through his ambition to get on, and nothing else, coming into contact with the state treasurer and the governor. They were going to consider his case personally, because he demanded that it be considered, nothing more. Others more influential than himself had quite as much right to a share, but they didn't take it. Nerve, ideas, aggressiveness, how these counted when one had luck. He went away thinking how surprised Drexel and Company and Cook and Company would be to see him appearing in the field as a competitor. In his home, in a little room on the second floor next to his bedroom, which he had fixed up as an office with a desk, a safe, and a leather chair, he consulted his resources. There were so many things to think of. He went over again the list of people whom he had seen and whom he could count on to subscribe, and in so far as that was concerned, the award of $1 million, he was safe. He figured to make 2% on the total transaction, or $20,000.
If he did, he was going to buy a house out on Gerard Avenue beyond the Butlers, or better yet, buy a piece of ground and erect one, mortgaging house and property so to do.
His father was prospering nicely. He might want to build a house next to him, and they could live side by side. His own business, aside from this deal, would yield him $10,000 this year. His streetcar investments, aggregating $50,000, were paying 6%. His wife's property, represented by this house, some government bonds, and some real estate in West Philadelphia, amounted to $40,000 more. Between them, they were rich, but he expected to be much richer.
All he needed now was to keep cool. If he succeeded in this bond issue matter, he could do it again and on a larger scale.
There would be more issues. He turned out the light after a while and went into his wife's boudoir, where she was sleeping. The nurse and the children were in a room beyond. "Well, Lillian," he observed when she awoke and turned over toward him, "I think I have that bond matter that I was telling you about arranged at last. I think I'll get $1 million of it anyhow. That'll mean $20,000. If I do, we'll build out on Gerard Avenue. That's going to be the street. The college is making that neighborhood."
"That'll be fine, won't it, Frank?" she observed, and rubbed her arm as he sat on the side of the bed. Her remark was vaguely speculative. "We'll have to show the Butlers some attention from now on. He's been very nice to me, and he's going to be useful. I can see that. He asked me to bring you over sometime. We must go. Be nice to his wife. He can do a lot for me, if he wants to. He has two daughters, too. We'll have to have them over here."
"I'll have them to dinner sometime," she agreed cheerfully and helpfully, "and I'll stop and take Mrs. Butler driving if she'll go, or she can take me."
She had already learned that the Butlers were rather showy, the younger generation, that they were sensitive as to their lineage, and that money, in their estimation, was supposed to make up for any deficiency in any other respect. "Butler himself is a very presentable man," Cowperwood had once remarked to her, "but Mrs. Butler, well, she's all right, but she's a little commonplace. She's a fine woman, though, I think, good-natured and good-hearted." He cautioned her not to overlook Eileen and Nora, because the Butlers, mother and father, were very proud of them. Mrs. Cowperwood at this time was 32 years old, Cowperwood 27. The birth and care of two children had made some difference in her looks. She was no longer as softly pleasing, more angular. Her face was hollow-cheeked, like so many of Rossetti's and Burne-Jones' women. Her health was really not as good as it had been, the care of two children, and a late undiagnosed tendency toward gastritis having reduced her. In short, she was a little run down nervously and suffered from fits of depression. Cowperwood had noticed this.
He tried to be gentle and considerate, but he was too much of a utilitarian and practical-minded observer not to realize that he was likely to have a sickly wife on his hands later. Sympathy and affection were great things, but desire and charm must endure, or one was compelled to be sadly conscious of their loss. So often now he saw young girls who were quite in his mood, and who were exceedingly robust and joyous. It was fine, advisable, practical, to adhere to the virtues as laid down in the current social lexicon. But if you had a sickly wife, and anyhow, was a man entitled to only one wife? Must he never look at another woman? Supposing he found someone? He pondered those things between hours of labor, and concluded that it did not make so much difference. If a man could, and not be exposed, it was all right. He had to be careful, though. Tonight, as he sat on the side of his wife's bed, he was thinking somewhat of this, for he had seen Eileen Butler again, playing and singing at her piano, as she passed the parlor door. She was like a bright bird radiating health and enthusiasm, a reminder of youth in general. "It's a strange world," he thought, but his thoughts were his own, and he didn't propose to tell anyone about them. The bond issue, when it came, was a curious compromise, for although it netted him his $20,000 and more, and served to introduce him to the financial notice of Philadelphia and the state of Pennsylvania, it did not permit him to manipulate the subscriptions as he had planned. The state treasurer was seen by him at the office of a local lawyer of great repute, where he worked when in the city. He was gracious to Cowperwood, because he had to be. He explained to him just how things were regulated at Harrisburg. The big financiers were looked to for campaign funds. They were represented by henchmen in the state assembly and senate. The governor and the treasurer were foot-free. But there were other influences: prestige, friendship, social power, political ambitions, etc. The big men might constitute a close corporation, which in itself was unfair. But after all, they were the legitimate sponsors for big money loans of this kind. The state had to keep on good terms with them, especially in times like these. Seeing that Mr. Cowperwood was so well able to dispose of the million he expected to get, it would be perfectly all right to award it to him. But Van Nostrand had a counter-proposition to make. Would Cowperwood, if the financial crowd now handling the matter so desired, turn over his award to them for a consideration, a sum equal to what he expected to make, in the event the award was made to him? Certain financiers desired this. It was dangerous to oppose them. They were perfectly willing he should put in a bid for $5 million and get the prestige of that. To have him awarded $1 million and get the prestige of that was well enough also. But they desired to handle the $23 million in an unbroken lot. It looked better. He need not be advertised as having withdrawn. They would be content to have him achieve the glory of having done what he started out to do. Just the same, the example was bad. Others might wish to imitate him. If it were known in the street privately that he had been coerced, for a consideration, into giving up, others would be deterred from imitating him in the future. Besides, if he refused, they could cause him trouble. His loans might be called. Various banks might not be so friendly in the future. His constituents might be warned against him in one way or another. Cowperwood saw the point. He acquiesced. It was something to have brought so many high and mighties to their knees. So they knew of him. They were quite well aware of him. Well and good. He would take the award and $20,000 or thereabouts and withdraw. The state treasurer was delighted. It solved a ticklish proposition for him.
"I'm glad to have seen you," he said. "I'm glad we've met. I'll drop in and talk with you sometime when I'm down this way. We'll have lunch together."
The state treasurer, for some odd reason, felt that Mr. Cowperwood was a man who could make him some money. His eye was so keen, his expression was so alert, and yet so subtle. He told the governor and some other of his associates about him. So the award was finally made. Cowperwood, after some private negotiations in which he met the officers of Drexel and Company, was paid his $20,000 and turned his share of the award over to them. New faces showed up in his office now from time to time, among them that of Van Nostrand and one Terence Relihan, a representative of some other political forces at Harrisburg. He was introduced to the governor one day at lunch. His name was mentioned in the papers, and his prestige grew rapidly. Immediately he began working on plans with young Ellsworth for his new house. He was going to build something exceptional this time, he told Lillian. They were going to have to do some entertaining on a larger scale than ever. North Front Street was becoming too tame. He put the house up for sale, consulted with his father, and found that he also was willing to move. The son's prosperity had redounded to the credit of the father.
The directors of the bank were becoming much more friendly to the old man. Next year, President Kugel was going to retire. Because of his son's noted coup, as well as his long service, he was going to be made president. Frank was a large borrower from his father's bank. By the same token, he was a large depositor. His connection with Edward Butler was significant. He sent his father's bank certain accounts which it otherwise could not have secured. The city treasurer became interested in it, and the state treasurer. Cowperwood Sr. stood to earn $20,000 a year as president, and he owed much of it to his son. The two families were now on the best of terms. Anna, now 21, and Edward and Joseph frequently spent the night at Frank's house. Lillian called almost daily at his mother's. There was much interchange of family gossip, and it was thought well to build side by side. So Cowperwood Sr. bought 50 feet of ground next to his son's 35, and together they commenced the erection of two charming, commodious homes, which were to be connected by a covered passageway, or pergola, which could be enclosed with glass in winter. The most popular local stone, a green granite, was chosen, but Mr. Ellsworth promised to present it in such a way that it would be especially pleasing. Cowperwood Sr. decided that he could afford to spend $75,000. He was now worth $250,000, and Frank decided that he could risk $50,000, seeing that he could raise money on a mortgage. He planned at the same time to remove his office farther south on 3rd Street and occupy a building of his own. He knew where an option was to be had on a 25-foot building, which, though old, could be given a new brownstone front and made very significant. He saw in his mind's eye a handsome building, fitted with an immense plate-glass window, inside his hardwood fixtures visible, and over the door, or to one side of it, set in bronze letters, Cowperwood and Company. Vaguely but surely he began to see looming before him, like a fleecy-tinted cloud on the horizon, his future fortune. He was to be rich, very, very rich.